Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming. I'd like to call this meeting to order.
Okay, we'll start with the roll call. Ms. Barrick?
Here.
Ms. Ettich?
Here.
Ms. Hubbard?
Present.
Mr. Jacobs?
Present.
Dr. Sophia? Ms. Marshall?
Here.
Ms. Mendelson? Mr. Newman?
Here.
Dr. O'Donnell?
Here.
Ms. Shereen?
Here.
Dr. Smith? And Ms. Duncan? Here. Okay, we have a call.
Thank you. Okay, first of all, would you please turn your cell phones off or silence them? And then we will rise to the podium.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Adoption of minutes of November 19th. Does anyone have any changes, corrections?
I will be accepting minutes.
Yes, we have a... Okay.
It's item number 10.
Item number 10, okay.
Versus Ms. Shereen, the county attorney's office. Be invited to discuss the requested bond is agenda item. Well, I didn't use the word bond. It might be quite important because we don't want, and it's been, by the way, the county, as far as I know, I don't know if the county attorney was ever invited or not, but we don't want to limit her just to discussing bond cases because, and I don't think that Ms. Newman mentioned bond cases either, but I certainly did not say bond cases because that would limit what the county attorney will be addressing if she does come, hopefully. So I want her to address, and I didn't say bond here. It's all the cases that are being held so long at the end of the election year is what I was talking about.
Okay. Get that correction.
So you'd like, would you like it to say, requested,
to discuss the...
Court hold cases?
No. To discuss the, I don't remember my exact words, I just know I never said bond.
Okay.
But we want her to discuss, try to find solutions for all the animals that are kept here so long at the animal care center. Not just the bond cases, but other cases too, at which the animals are kept here for so long.
Okay.
Any other corrections? Okay, do I have a motion to accept the amended minutes?
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Second, yes. Welfare and Dangerous Cases, August through November 2015, and recent folds and snapshot. Okay, snapshot. Okay. We all had, I have a proposal in the packet you got, and because it was such a significant number of paper, I asked that things be emailed. So if you would like hard copy in the future, ask Michael.
Hopefully
we're not going to have it that large. Anyway, you'll see there's a suggestion to have a comments form in the packet. And what I would like to do is start using this type of form and add the current, the present meeting, like we would have at the end of, it would, I guess, start in January. We would get February's cases or either hard copy or a couple days later get them by email. And then a comment form for each set. And then get these back to Michael so that he could actually put a summary together so we could actually have a snapshot. I actually took all of the cases and I did my own table. And on this table, I'll actually pass it out so y'all can see what I did. And, you know, these are my comments, so you can afford them if you wish. But I took on here the case number under welfare, and I actually wrote down the officer's name. Yes.
Is there one for the public?
Well, I can actually have a couple out here. I haven't put a committee number since this is just proposed. But this is not the form that I'm planning, but this just was kind of the idea. And I was trying to figure out what ordinances, how it fits. But I took the comments from the memo that we generally get. The operations supervisor gives us a summary. And then I put an area for comments, and then I put my name next to it. So kind of what I would like to do is actually have a form that just has the welfare case and the case number, and a place for a committee member to make comments and then put their name, send it back, and Michael can cut and paste. And then what I would ultimately like to do, you guys are going to have to share some of these. This is what I call a snapshot. And I apologize, I just threw this together this afternoon. On this snapshot, I took the report that the enforcement report we normally get, and I took the portion that shows the information about what the law is and some comments from the officers and information on the animals and their vaccinations and the card or whatever. There's an area up here that has the comments from the memo that we get from the supervisor on the dispensation of whatever happened. And I clipped and pasted all of the officers' actual writing on the report so it's easy to read. And then there's a place at the bottom I have placed for comments from the committee members. And that's what I would like ultimately to happen is then when we come to the meetings, we have a snapshot of each case. So everything is all in one place. You're not flipping back and forth. And you can actually see what the committee members have thought about. And this is to expedite the meeting because sometimes we do either don't get to the cases or we get tied up in a lot of cases and we don't get to some of the other topics. And so if we have a guide like this, what I would like to do is have it so that if we see a case that there are numerous comments. Ms. Mendelson just came, please, in the record. We could say, okay, this one doesn't seem to have a lot of comments, but this one has 5 or 6 comments. We need to address this case. So this is just kind of a quick snapshot. This can go into the official record in 20 minutes as part of what the discussion was. And so this is my idea. I don't know if people are like the idea of comments sending them in and then they're written and we can just get a quick idea of what's going on. So that's what I was talking about on this part, and then I do have some comments on cases, so that was on the proposed comment sheet, so I combined it with the cases, so we can, if one serves any comments on this.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
This is one of the welfare cases that we've
yes,
got in our packet.
Yes, that's the first one.
And this is the what?
Okay, the when we get our packet, we get this report right here. This report that the enforcement officer submits. Mm-hmm. And what I did is I took the PDF, I received this in a PDF, and I have Acrobat Pro, and I'm hoping you do too. And all I did, there's a snapshot tool on it, and I highlighted an area, and it copied it. And I pasted it into Word as like a picture or an image. And into that, that's exactly what this is here. And then the bottom part on this form, I did the same thing with the officer's writing and I put it below. The supervisor's comments were from the memo that we get from the ACO that reviews everything, so we have it all in one place. And so that's where that came together. At the bottom of the form, you'll see my comment. And then I just said, member X, comment, and whatever it was. Just so that we could see, and this way, we actually say, okay, the committee has reviewed it, we're seeing something, and we get an overall picture. And if somebody's got a question, they can put it in there saying, I don't understand this, and it's right there so we can address it. And if we say, hey, it looks great, or there's not a lot with it, we can make our comments on whatever we're seeing, and then it's a record so somebody can get back. Yes, ma'am.
Do you want to change the format that we receive this in to this? Mm-hmm. And that we can get it ahead of time, that we will have our comments written down ahead of time so we don't hold up the meeting.
Precisely. Okay. So we would be getting this, and this is another step. It's kind of homework for the committee.
Okay.
And then this is a summary that this snapshot, as I call it, and it goes into the record. It can be part of the minutes or whatever that says the cases have been reviewed, the committee is reviewing the operations as we're supposed to be doing, and checking to see whatever. And this was very enlightening. When I went through, because this is my snapshot of every case,
right.
And I noticed we have more than one enforcement form. One just says license, one says license or vaccinations. So I actually was looking at all the little boxes, so I find it was a 15-hour homework assignment, guys, so sorry. And so, but this is kind of what I had in mind, because we're trying to get, we're getting more and more and more asked of us, or trying to keep moving towards philosophies and getting it on track. And the cases are very, very important, and too often we don't get to it. And so this was my idea, a comment sheet. And this way, committee members can say, yeah, okay, I've got the comments now. If I got them at the meeting, I have 2.5 weeks to get these things reviewed, get the information to Michael, and he can just cut and paste and pop it in there, and everybody's on the same track. And also, when our ACO supervisors come, they're going to see the committee comments here, so they're going to know what we want to know before they get here. So it's kind of an aid for them. So if you say, I've got redeemed, or how did they comply? They would know, and they'd say, well, I went and looked it up, not, well, I have to get back next month. So this is a time saver. So.
And one question.
Sure.
We're going to get this a week before the meeting?
No.
Okay, that's because I'm worried about the open.
What I said is, okay, what I would like to do is have our cases. So say this was the January meeting.
Okay.
And at the end of the January meeting, those people who requested hard copies of the cases would get their hard copies.
Right.
The rest of the committee members who want it electronically would get it in their in-basket.
Okay.
And so they could review it on their computer, and they would have their comment form that they could enter everything in. And I asked that a week and a half before, so you'd have about 2 weeks to get your comments into Michael, so he's got time to compile the report.
And then get it out in time.
And then get it out in time with the packet. So when the packet comes, you can sit there and read everybody's comments.
Okay.
So this was my idea. So it's more homework for us, but I think ultimately we're going to be more on the same page. Everybody's going to have the same information and see what everybody's thinking about. And for instance, you may be looking at something and catch something I don't catch. I'm going to say, well, this is what I'm looking at. So it was just a thought. So I don't know. Can I have some feedback?
Yes, I like your format. You have three different pieces of information. Previously different documents on the board.
Okay.
Is Michael comfortable doing this?
Michael hasn't seen this.
Okay. Well, what I'm thinking, looking at your example here, there's one dog that was part of the case, but we always get the cases where there's 8 or 9.
Right.
So does it kick down the snapshot easy to push it to page 2?
Yeah, you can't. It's just a PDF snapshot. And with Lovely Chameleon, I don't know. I'm hoping that there's a way we can actually have it so it's not so tiny. This idea came to me at 9 o'clock this morning, and I put it together by about 10. So, but like I said, I had already done a lot of prep work on this, and I thought, how can we get this information so it's easy for the committee to read? And not have to say, okay, well, I'm here, so let's go back to this piece of paper. Let's have it all on one one thing, so.
That comes up a lot, we go like WC9.
And you're.
And you go back to the summary comments.
So this way, if you've got it here, and then you've got the officer summary, and you've got the ACO summary, because it could be that when they see the snapshot, the ACO may go back and say, wait a minute, I want to go back and check this, because I've got this paper here, and this is what the committee members, well, maybe we need to go back and readdress some of this situation. And then when they come to the meeting, they can actually say to Michael, and they give us another sheet saying, we've gone back and here's another update. So they're ready to go. So more feedback?
That's great.
Okay, so.
So am I iterating this and this?
No, just that.
So in theory, there'll be 110 of these. 11 members, 10.
Okay, no, okay. What I hope will happen with this snapshot is that there will be one snapshot per case. At the bottom of each snapshot, there is an area for the committee members. See where it says?
Right.
Okay, so.
So I make 10 of these.
You make 10 of those.
Because of 10 cases.
Right.
And then these get dispersed, but then they can come back.
Right. No, okay. Okay. What I would like to see is that you'll make 10 of those, okay? And, or no, I'm sorry. You will still make these packets, okay? You will send out the memo. The committee can read it. The committee can read it. And then they will have the actual case record to read. The summary is what goes into, so at the February meeting, the snapshot is what's going to come out in the packets for everybody to read. So it's a refresher. You read these cases. You made your comments. So we get the full-size packet for everybody to look at. Tell me how you're confusing everybody. We read our cases, and we have a comment sheet. And actually, the committee comments can say, it can have all 10 welfare on one case. It says welfare 1, welfare 2, welfare 3. And the committee member fills in their comments for welfare 1, and the committee member slots writes their name on it. They fill all 10 questions out on one form, email it back to you or fax it back to you, and then the joy of word processing, you copy and paste it in to the summary form. I'll work with you on that, okay? If you want me to, because it goes pretty quickly when you're just pulling and sliding in. And that way everything hopefully will be typed, or it's very quickly to go in and say, committee member X said this, and you can see what's going on. So it's a little bit of homework for everybody, but ultimately it's a snapshot. The committee reviewed it, had concerns, and then in the minutes they can say, well, we looked at snapshot 1, welfare case 1, and the ultimate thing is it went to the committee and they said we wanted more information because we've reviewed all these comments, or everybody says it's fine, we saw what everybody said and we don't need to discuss it, that's fine. It's just a little more paperwork, it's a little more thorough, but I did see the need for some uniformity in the reports, and I'm sure everybody has seen this. I mean, we were overwhelmed by this, but I think that everybody, we know we're looking at it, and we know that we can put things in there that I might not say, and I will tell you that some of my comments here are... I was really looking at this to see how we could make this go faster, but be very comprehensive. And I thought, if I could put this down, think about it before I got to the meeting and say, yes, this is what I wanted concisely. It's not random. And this is concise. And with regard to that, just for example, I mean, you all have snapshot 1. I'm going to say, okay, I have my snapshot here. And I want to look at what case was it? I'm just going to bring it up here. There's a case number in September. It's case 1. Okay. The animal in this case on September 1, case 1, welfare case of September 1, the dog was adopted from PAC. It was in good health. Unfortunately, this dog had to be euthanized in September because it was in such bad shape. I pulled right from the officer's comments. Dog adopted from PAC January 2015. Quote, first time pet owner. It's not an excuse for a neglect. And this was September's welfare case 1.
This one.
if you're looking at that, and putting it in black and white, you know, when I'm writing out these comments and I'm thinking about this, that's very, very concise. It takes no time at all to put it in under the snapshot. What I did put on here, which I should have put on here, is recommend that this person be, that's the only pet he's been allowed to have. Because I want the judge to be put into, you know, just say, no, you can't have any more animals. But to be told, I adopted the animal, we had care of that animal. It was adopted, and the person just said, well, yeah, it was sick, but I'm a first-time pet owner, so, but it's right here. And when I reread this, it really stood up. And you can tell I'm here when I'm really angry because I went bold, and then I went capitals. Like I said, just going through here, and the committee members will see a lot of places where I think that people should be recommended not to have animals. There's another one. In October, welfare case number 2. Does anybody remember reading about an animal being called out in distress? The person thought the animal was going to die. It was a Bichon mix. It's on a tie-out. Officer said it seemed to be okay, but that officer was investigating and heard another sound. And under a tarp, there was a cage that had a chihuahua standing in feces. Old feces. There was no mention on the enforcement report about that dog. Just a comment about the chihuahua. There's nothing in there to indicate what was done about the chihuahua. And if I wasn't sitting there going, okay, let me write this out, I probably would have forgotten. I would have highlighted it and go, well, what did I mean? So, and it might be that somebody on the committee might say, well, you know, I skimmed it, it looked okay from the report, the person was cited, but then they see the comments and say, you know what? We need to find out what's going on here. So this is another reason I want a comment sheet. That it's in writing, everybody can see it, and we don't always have time for all of us to speak. And I'm sorry, so I'm going to shut up and open up the floor. Anybody have any comments on any of the welfare or this?
Can you cut me off at your side, Michael? We usually get our report back, I'd say 7 to 10 days before a meeting, right? Is that correct?
Yeah.
2 weeks. More? Further minutes?
Well, no. It usually, when did you get your packet?
I want to say about a week ago.
Monday.
Okay, so do we have time to get the packet, email you back the comments, and have you have time to put them on?
Well, it sounds like we're adding another month delay here.
Oh.
No, because if we get the animals that we're looking at, because you pull the animals, we've got Novembers in here. We have some from November, and usually we get them from the month before in the packet. They're not from that month that we're looking at. So technically, you're pulling the cases that we would be looking at anyway, but we're just getting them at the time of the meeting for the next month for discussion.
Well, I get the report sent to me from staff. I mean, if they can get it to me sooner, I can get it to you sooner.
Okay.
But I can't speak.
Right. It's just like having the reports pulled and having them ready to go at the advisory committee meeting for the next month. Is that what you're doing here?
My general philosophy is to have as much information backing up whatever is on the agenda so that we as members and the public know in as much specificity as possible what it is we're going to discuss, and if there is an action to be taken, what action is to be taken in writing. That's my general philosophy. Mm-hmm. So generally I would support what you're saying, but I think we need to have the administration return with their comments. This is the first time they've seen it. Mm-hmm. And meet with you with the notion that, and I would ask the committee to agree to this notion, that we would prefer to have this kind of information available. What does it take, and how could we get it done? And if it's a matter, for me, of 1 month delay, we already have delayed 6 months, another month. What we're after is the information and the right comments for correction. not timing us in this particular case, in my opinion. Thank you.
I have some comments about the cases, not about...
Okay.
But are we still talking about your...
We're talking about the case. I put the comment sheet because I introduced something that was in the packet, a comment sheet for people to write on. So, okay.
Well, I would like to go on record as saying, I think this is great. I think this is the ability to give us all, the ability to look at something and actually discuss it, rather than always having one person bring it to our attention because we either didn't read it or we passed over it. So I like the idea of it. And whether PAC administratively can do it, I'm sure you guys can work something out on how to get it done. So I'm in favor of it. I think it's a great idea.
I think it's a good idea, and I do think that it needs to be discussed with the administration to see how practical it is for them to do it. I also think that if we decide to go ahead of it, we should do it, a trial period of 3 or 4 months and see how it works, rather than just, because it may work just the way we imagine it, or it may not, or it may need to be tweaked or something.
Any other comments?
So in theory, if we had wanted to do this for those items that are on the agenda tonight, we each would have sent in comments that would have covered 10 sheets of paper.
Right. Well, that's what I chose to do. In theory, it would not have been because I put excess information in there.
Well, but you have a comment section.
Right.
And you're asking each of us to comment or not comment on each one of these cases. Is that correct?
I didn't comment on all the cases. I did on the majority of them, but there are some I did not. But, I took it and just started writing. But you don't have to. If you agree with what was gone or you don't see anything, you don't have to make any comments.
I'm just trying to get an idea of what administration is going to be receiving and what we're going to get back. That's all. It's an information process that I'm trying to develop.
Basically, what I thought was you would get a sheet that says welfare case one in the case of him here. And with this, like you got a comment sheet here, just like you got in the packet. This is basically the comment sheet. You read your case that you saw each month had a comment sheet.
See, I thought that was a comment sheet for some other
administrator. No, this is not. So what you could do, and a lot of times, so you got a welfare case here, and you could write your comments in here and send it back to Michael. And that's all you have to do.
So he's going to receive...
And he's going to receive...
Each of the packets back from each of us.
He's going to receive the form. And we should not have this number of cases.
So it's 10, 12 cases a month.
10, 12 cases a month. And so he gets the paper back, and he can just slide the comments in. And then when the actual packet goes out and they have the snapshot, you can read what the other committee members suggested it, and if you want to open it.
As I said, I agree with what you're proposing. I'm just trying to make sure I understand what I'm agreeing to.
I know, it's just a different mindset, but I'm tired of going to this all in one meeting.
We could just do it in email, right?
That's correct.
We get those electronically.
We have
a comment section. You can fill it out electronically and return
it. Send it back. Makes it easy. So that's what I was thinking. So that's... Yes, ma'am.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to close one and apply for the next month. And then we can report back and let you guys know how much time it took and all of that. And make sure that we can put this together for you all to see how it goes.
Okay. Sounds good. Everybody agree to that? Okay. Okay, now here's the thing. I chose what I thought would work on the comments. So if there's something that you look at, you might want to suggest it so that if they decide to do a different form. So I just, as I said, I threw this thing together. And if there's something you see it's important, like I said, I wanted to see who the officers were. In case there's one who's really gone above and beyond, you say, oh, kudos to the officer or whatever. There's one in here for Dr. Wilcox on my comments. So if there's something in particular you want to look at, you guys look at, please do, because it's, I just was trying to make it in one place, so I don't know these meetings, I'm not switching back and forth in part time, so.
I think we could resolve a lot of what you're talking about by just trying it.
Okay, great, thank you. Okay, so all those in favor, trying it, Bobby?
Aye.
Call me, I'll come help you set up the first ones, if you need.
In the same time.
Okay, Mish, please.
Wanted to go through some of these.
Yes, Mish Wery wanted to go some of these.
Mish Wery.
Commented, she's Wery. Okay, thank you, okay, Mish Wery?
I'll try to condense it, it won't be, because we're short of time, and just to say it's terribly cruel, it won't, I don't know if it'll get through to you, but I have to be fast. Anyway, on the welfare cases for August number 6, this is notable not only because of the extreme cruelty, the paw was falling off due to the bandage being too tight. Dog had been adopted from cat. That's what makes one reason it's really notable. Owner said it was okay because Pack was going to euthanize him anyway. And then as for staff reviewing animal welfare requirements and laws with the owner, I find it very hard to believe that that really happened. And I noticed that in every single one of these cases, it says that. It's just like there's a computer where you just press a button and it just types out these words every time. I do not. The staff reviewed animal welfare requirements and laws with the owner, even though, I mean, a lot of good that does. In former days, it would say we educated the owner, and then they changed it to reduce. And the report doesn't bear out the fact, the actual report of this case says at that point the owner stated that he no longer wished to speak with me, and I ceased trying to interview him and instead explained his citations to him. And anyway, the actual account of this simply doesn't bear out the fact that the staff reviewed animal welfare requirements and laws with the owner. And I question that this is just printed out automatically in every single. The next one that's notable is number 7. There were 69 animals impounded. Conditions were simply terrible, terrible. But it says here one or two cats were left behind. And my comment is I'd like Pat to go back and find those one or two cats. Going on to September. Terrible suffering for this dog. Number one. Was euthanized at Pat. To note the fact that this dog was adopted from Pat. The owner never took the dog to a vet. And then the person who wrote the report said this dog was impounded at no charge to the owner. And remember, this involved terrible suffering for the dog. And I'm glad they didn't charge the owner, but why did they say that? They imply that sometimes they do charge an owner to impound a dog. That when they impound a dog that's been cruelly treated, they don't ever charge the owner, do they? I hope.
Madam Chair, I'm going to ask Mr. Chavez or Officer Tenkate if they can help answer that. Mm-hmm.
that one, Jenson?
Was this owner cited? It doesn't say. Was he cited? I mean, it sounded like this animal was sick for a while and he wasn't cited. Or was he cited?
Yes, he was cited.
Oh, he was cited. Okay, I can see that. Okay, thank you.
He was cited. He was put on a do not adopt list because it was not an acceptable condition that the dog was returned back in.
All right, thank you.
I believe there was some medical on this dog that was done after we took it back in, even though we did adopt this dog out in January.
Right.
And it appeared healthy. This dog did have some underlying health conditions, but he failed to ever take it to a vet.
Yes,
sir.
I think we can learn from this discussion and your comment. Your comment only repeats what is said, not what you wish somebody to do or what you think needs to be done. For example, when you read this, you actually had an action statement that you had in mind.
And I didn't do it because I was...
So I personally would ask that we think not of just comment, but action. Do you want an action or you have a question? That's what I think we need to put down. Not comment, but what action, question do you have? Just my suggestion, listening to what we've heard tonight.
But sometimes a comment is appropriate because it will jog your memory as to exactly what that person
I wasn't trying to limit what people say, but I'm just reading here and I get comments, but not what does it, what does that mean? It means that you want certain things to happen or not happen, or you believe certain things.
I think your comments are pretty much optional as to what you want to say.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. It's not limited. However you want.
I was trying to be helpful in terms
it
of
was, yeah.
in
it
terms was. Of the, what the, how they're going to respond to this comment. Is much different than what the questions that we just asked them.
Well, getting back to that comment, mm-hmm. I thought it was notable that the dog was adopted from PAC. Mm-hmm. Just reinforces the idea that people who adopt animals from PAC need to be very carefully screened, and I am actually opposed to the free adoptions because the owners are not. A lot of them are not being screened, and I know people who told me they adopted animals from PAC and they were never screened. So that's my point of commenting on all the ones that are adopted from PAC. And then my other question was, why say that the dog was impounded at no charge to the owner? I mean, that's good, but isn't nobody answered my question. Isn't that always the case, that when you impound animals in cruelty cases, you don't ever charge the owner?
That is correct. We do not charge them. If somebody called us and wanted a pickup fee for an animal that had no issues at all, there are fees, a pickup fee, and obviously an assessment fee of $15 besides the pickup fee for the $75, which is totally $90. But on a welfare case, no. We would ask them to relinquish ownership of the dog at that time and pick up the dog. We don't charge.
Well, that brings the issue then that this committee should address. See what I'm saying? The issue we should address is the question you asked and the answer we got. Does this committee support that procedure and operation and policy? And we don't have an opportunity to discuss that. We have only an opportunity to discuss what happened to the dog. And we have to go beyond that at some point.
Would you like that policy put on as an agenda item?
Not my question. I don't necessarily support her position. So if she has a position and she has something she wants on the agenda, I think it's the person who made the statement and who had thought and decided she wants that policy discussed by the committee.
Well,
Anybody can on the agenda. Doesn't have to be the person that has the question.
I agree, but I don't have to do it either.
No, that's true.
I think the repercussion or what we're seeing as we go through these and we get certain answers will bear out certain things that we want to look at. Like, for example, this, or like if you're interested in this not being something that you would like the outcome to be. The other thing is that I have a question of what repercussions does an individual actually get for abusing an animal? For in this a case like this, or and there's a multitude of issues in this list of comments, such as the dog that was sitting in feces and they left it there in a little cage for God knows how long. I mean, what do we do to those people other than just take the dog away?
Do we take the dog away?
And then hopefully we do take the dog
away. Typically, the animals are impounded or they're sighted and there is a recheck done. If the animals remain in their custody, they have to come into compliance, but they are issued the citations for any welfare violations that are observed. And they also check for the license and vaccination on each of the animals.
So let's say on this particular case where you took the dog, right?
Mm-hmm. Did they take one dog and leave one dog? Is that the one that you were talking about originally, the dog that was in feces? The chihuahua that was underneath the porch?
Right.
And that would be from August?
I don't know the date.
I think somebody said it was from August. I'm trying to remember the cases in my head.
I see.
And I believe that was probably on North Davis
Avenue. That was October.
Avenue. Was it on Davis Avenue?
That was October. And it's case two.
Okay, it was...
There you go.
No. Yeah, it was October's case number two. Okay, so in this situation, you have... Did you leave the one dog there and take another dog with you?
It's case 15180.
I think that's it. Let's see here.
One dog was impounded, I believe, on this one. The dog on the tie-out. The dog that they tied out would be Sean. The other dog was in a kennel crate. Not a small kennel crate. There was 1 to 2 days worth of solid waste in a kennel. The dog had access to clean water. So that dog in particular was in fact left because it met the requirements.
I'd also like to know why it wasn't noted on the report. It was written in the written report, but it was not on it was not on the investigation report. It only has the Bichon on here. The Chihuahua is mentioned in this report, but it is not on this report. And here again, there's license and vaccination. The form's changed, so there's.
It's just what I couldn't. Did you just say they found this?
So you're saying that, and this dog met the dog that was in the crate that you left.
Yes.
Met all the criteria.
For the welfare. So she took the dog that was in violation.
Where is that criteria, though? I mean, when
it's in the law itself. Any dog that is on a tie-out is considered in distress.
I understand that one. Let's see the other one.
The animal must be provided with adequate
exercise space, you know, all the animal care requirements, potable water, food that is of nutritional value for the animal to keep it in good weight or health. Ventilation is an issue there. This dog met every criteria. It was not on a
farm. It was under a tarp. Would that be?
Well, it was under a tarp. I believe that was under the tarp under which kept it shaded. I believe it was the tarp was drawn.
The tarp was all the way around, my understanding is all the way around this cage. Because he didn't see the dog until the tarp was lifted. And it gives one the impression, by whoever's writing this, that that person is trying to hide this animal.
It says here that there was a...
May I ask a question? Is this the dog that was in a crate in the feces?
Yeah, it had like 1 or 2 days worth of feces. It wasn't coated, it wasn't, you know, piled in with feces.
But what you're saying is it was inhabiting a crate that was...
Yeah, it was a large crate.
So you consider that the water would be potable and the food would be of good quality if it's involved with the feces?
It had a bowl of water in there just like anybody else would put in a crate. It was clean water.
Was this crate? No comment. I mean, was
it? I don't have a photo of the crate.
The thing is that I mean, I would consider several days worth of solid material to not be acceptable.
That's right. Well, it had one to two days of solid waste, according to the officer. So, for a small chihuahua, I don't know what, you know, it wouldn't be that much. And typically, within the county law, it is the waste would have to be removed every 72 hours, so up to 3 days. We wouldn't expect a dog that would have to stand in that cage all that time to have that.
So this was a large cage?
Yeah.
How big?
I don't know.
It had a small accumulation of waste. We have the report. It said the kennel had a small accumulation of waste. It doesn't say how much. I'm just telling you what it says. But I don't think we should get it in there.
Well, because you're going, you're eating.
Yeah, I agree.
Mm-hmm. And you're living, eating, defecating, drinking, all in this cage.
And breathing. What action would you like us?
Well, I guess, like I said, it bears out questions. I mean, you're reading these things, and the questions, it almost like, you can almost guess what our questions are going to be. Right? I mean, why does the dog
live?
Oh, sorry,
Mr. Davis. That's not the question I had at all. The question is, I just heard there's some rule, regulation, policy, law that says if the 72-hour limit, I'd like to review that, period. Then we get to the issue. Getting to the issue of talking about, did this officer make the right judgment? We have to understand what they were judging.
But that's typically 72 hours in the yard.
All I'm saying, we're now getting down to the discussion we should be having.
Exactly.
Right. I'm not here to...
No, I agree.
So, that's how I would have framed the question. The policy is 72 hours, therefore nothing happened. Members of the committee think the 72 hours should be 72 hours locked up in a crate. That's what we discussed, in my opinion.
I'd like to address your question, what you want us to do. What I want you to do is not allow people to keep animals in cages or crates. Something that I've been concerned about for 20 years, that people simply don't understand that just being confined in a cage or a crate is extreme cruelty. And that's what I would
suggest you put it on the agenda so we can discuss it. Mm-hmm. I'd like to discuss that in depth, that issue about dogs in a crate, since I have 10 of them in the crate.
Most of us crate our animals.
Some items for future agenda.
My question is, what's the purpose of putting it on the agenda?
Because she hasn't been able to have an answer for 20 years.
No, that's not true, she has.
I don't know that's true, because I assume people tell me the truth when I hear it in open public meetings. I'm not questioning her veracity. Now, if you have information...
We do, and if you go back in the records, it was discussed.
Then bring them up so I can see it, please.
Maybe we can find that, because we have discussed this crazy issue.
Fine, we discussed it.
At nauseam.
But then we'll go...
Well, I wouldn't say I have a chance to bring it up that much, Pat.
You wrote a letter to my boss about it. Believe me, it came up a lot. And there is, you know, there's a difference between somebody who uses a dog crate as a tool, or somebody who puts a dog in a crate and forgets about it. You know, I mean, there's...
I'd love to be able to discuss, but it's not on the agenda.
It's on the... Okay.
Well, it is on the agenda.
Thank you.
No, we requested that topic be put on the agenda.
I just want to say this, and how can we discuss the...
Okay, we were talking about the situation of the animal this time. We were just going through the cases. The subject of crating an animal has been put on as an agenda item.
But it seems not just a question of crating, but all is different. How can we discuss the cruelty cases if we can't discuss all the various different kinds of cruelty that come up? I mean, crating is just one. It can be something else, some other kind of cruelty we ought to be able to discuss.
Can the staff sit down with the member and let him list all the cruelties and everything, we'll discuss it. I want to discuss it, I want to cover it, but I want to know what it is that you have in mind that you define as cruelty, so that we can discuss it and so the public will know about it.
Okay.
I don't think that we should stymie discussion by having to put down everything on an agenda when we are talking about specifically what the officer did or did not do, that we are in agreement or not in agreement with. Because every time we get into talking about if she says, well, they didn't have as much water as we think they should have, and then we say, well, then how much water did she have? Oh, it's got to be on the agenda. No. We have the right to have a discussion, and particularly when we're talking about a discussion on these issues, so without having to then stop and put it on the agenda, because we are talking right now about what our comments would be and what is going on with this particular animal. So I don't think we have to stop every single time. And that's not what the attorney said.
And I agree with you. But where I disagree with you is when the whole subject matter, which is a major concern, so when I that there is cruelty simply to have an animal in a crate. That's not discussion of this.
Yeah.
That's a discussion of something else.
I agree with you on that part. Right. I just don't want it stopped every single time.
I don't think you disagree.
Okay. And the fact of the matter is that if they're saying we have 72 hours worth of feces in a crate, that means that dog was in that crate for 72 hours, which is not to me.
We don't know that.
Well, what do we know?
We don't know anything.
Right.
Because we don't have any information about how long that dog was in the crate or not. We don't have any of that information. Right.
Nor do we know that dog may have gone in the crate, was taken out of a crate and put back in with a crate.
Right.
But we don't know.
We don't know.
We don't have a full picture of that dog, so we don't have a full report.
But I do know the dog was covered with a tarp. And if one starts to think about, why does one cover a dog with a tarp?
Because it stinks.
Because it stinks, or you don't want someone to see it. And so is there foul play of some sort going on? I mean, you don't hide something. Unless something must be going on and you don't want someone to see it.
I shave my dogs in crates, but covering the crate on occasion when that's necessary.
Well, yes, but there's ventilation.
We don't know about ventilation.
Why
he asked me. He had a hypothetical. I have the right to have a hypothetical too.
Dr. Smith,
I need water.
I can stay on this case. And we're talking about this case of crate, not what we do with our own dogs at home.
That's correct.
Well, Mr. Jenkins takes very good care of his dogs, as most of people, as everybody here does. But we're talking about this specific case with this dog that was in the crate with about 72 hours worth of feces in it. We don't know if the dog was in there all around the clock or put in there. We're sure if it was a dog being hidden from the officer because it didn't have a license. We don't know, which the question is, if we don't know, and the officer didn't even accept put it in passing, maybe this case needs to be further evaluated. Maybe this, we need to go find out what's going on with this chihuahua.
We did return back.
Okay. But there's nothing, was it mentioned about the chihuahua in the report? I didn't see that.
No, I believe that when they returned, the chihuahua was in the house. Chiki was outside. He did build a confinement for that dog.
Okay.
For the Bichon.
All right, and the chihuahua was
inside the home. In the trailer.
In the crate or not in the crate?
It must have, I don't
I'm
know.
I'm sorry,
he,
I don't
know. I can't tell you because I can't make up what the officer put here.
Since the crate issue became an issue, it should have been evaluated and discussed.
The officer doesn't state that the dog was in crate,
okay.
And the dog that he originally impounded that did get spayed here was
okay.
Out loose in a fence yard and had access to shade, shelter, and water.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Additional cases? Ms. Sherman?
I'm still on the same case. October, it's still the same case. Got the chihuahua in a cage or crate. And where he says, the owner says, I'm going to get a crate. And my complaint is that this suggests that pack is okay with crates. But I believe they are cruel.
Okay.
And I can get a lot of evidence for that too. Number 7 in October. I don't write down a complete summary, I just write down the points that I want to bring up. The owner cannot afford vet care. What makes that important is that there are so many owners who cannot afford vet care that are being adopted out. The cat is adopted and is out. Too many owners who cannot afford vet care. And this is just typical of all the thousands of people who cannot afford vet care for their animals that I know about. Last two were in November.
Good point. Is there any notion in that? If there wasn't, then the animal had been adopted from here?
Yeah, not that one.
Thank you.
Not that one, but several of these were. Okay, and I have mentioned two of them. Let's see.
What's the next case, Jane, please?
November number 3. And this indicated there might be approval for dog crates, which are cruel. This was bonded. This dog was extremely emaciated. This was a very, very cruel case. And the bond case was applied. And my question with this one is, what happened with the bond?
The bond is still in the process of organizing a hearing, another show cause hearing. That's where we're at in the bond notice.
Oh, you mean the owner paid the bond?
They paid the bond. They posted the bond.
That's quite unusual.
Yes.
This was case 3?
Yeah.
Really like to be able to attend that hearing. Could I find out when and where it is?
Yes, I will notify you.
Okay. Any more welfare cases?
Yeah, one more. Number The last one is number four, which was a very, there was a very confused narrative there. Dog named Jenna brought to pack for euthanasia. The fur was so matted, the dog could not even defecate normally. It was extremely emaciated, right eye protruding. Owner said, had gotten no vet care because couldn't afford vet care. There's another one that can't afford the vet care. And it says here, the pack officer gave information on no and low-cost veterinary care. And I happen to know, I'm very familiar with this, just what circumstances there might be low and low-cost veterinary care, but it's not going to be the way the pack officer gave the information out. Could I get a copy of that information that was given out?
Yes.
We would all like that, please.
Hmm?
We would all like that information, please.
And then the owner said it was a trivial matter. And later, the foster brought the dog back in. It was blind in one eye, had chronic pain, had seizures, tremors in legs, couldn't walk on two of its legs, and yet it's being kept alive here at Animal Control Center. And I'm not sure that's a really humane to keep that poor dog alive. And there was a confused, the narrative was quite confused. Okay, give me a minute. Let me dig this out. It's number three.
Okay, you guys ignore my comment on that because it looks like it got started. So. This is yes, somebody was this. But it says it was business here. This is the fourth date.
No, excuse me, it's number four.
Four, come on.
In October. November.
And it starts out. When I moved the text into the table, it got off, but that's the case she's talking about right there. Yes, that's what she's talking about. Dr. Wilcox was involved in this one.
Well, okay, I just gave you a summary of it. With all the terrible conditions this dog had, everything you can think of. And then even on top of all that blood and one eye crying and seizures. But on the narrative, it starts off September 3rd, 9/3/15. And this man brought in a dog that had named Gemma, had all kinds of things wrong with it. And then it says, at that point, the decision was made that citations needed to be issued for neglect of vet care. And then the next one says November 29th. It seems maybe there's a mistake in the way this was written.
I think Dr. Wilcox sent out an officer for a welfare check at the home. What happened with this is a dog, a lot of people, they bring in their animals to the back door, to the receiving area. And they are requesting euthanasia or even adoption on some of these animals that are neglected. What's happening is the animal care technicians book the animal in. Although they do notice that there are some welfare issues with the animal is still brought in, and then it is sent back to the pack vets to evaluate that animal.
Once the animal is evaluated, unfortunately, what happens is during this time, the dog owner has now left our area, our building, has gone home. So once the vet has made the decision and has documented everything, they send it back to enforcement, and hopefully, in this case, the address was given to us correctly, and we did go back and follow up and issue the citations and do a welfare check on all the other animals owned by this person.
But why was that 3 months later?
That's what it took to go back there. They did try to reach these people. A lot of times they'll go back to their to the calls in traffic. So somebody will continue to go back until we meet with an owner at that point in time. And I'm not sure what the time span was in with the documentation from the veterinary clinic, because I believe this dog, they were going to enucleate an eye on it and everything, and there was a lot of different things that were wrong with this dog.
Okay. Thank you for explaining the procedure. This was a, I mean, I didn't know, I thought people brought it in, turned it in for euthanasia or whatever, and this kind of, this was an educational thing by asking about this and the vet.
Yeah, sometimes when the pet owners that turn in their animals and the kennel staff reviews the animal and they notice that it's a, might be a welfare issue, and they bring it to the enforcement's attention, and then we'll send an officer out there to interview the owner and ask the pertinent questions as to if this dog was provided any treatment. If it hasn't been provided any treatment, then we go a little bit further in questioning, and then we feel that we can take enforcement action and issue citation for neglect vicar, then we do that on the spot.
So, right.
In some cases, like Supervisor Tenkate said, sometimes in this case, what we're talking about now, it went through the whole process, meaning it went through the intake process and then ended up in the veterinarian's process as far as examination. So when they discovered there was an issue, then they brought it to our attention, and then collectively the veterinarian and our field supervisor decided we should follow through with the welfare investigation and then take enforcement action for neglect vicar.
So in this case, if somebody brought an animal in like this, would the animal be placed like in a kennel, or would possibly the intake kennel staff take it immediately to the veterinarian? I'm just trying to decide how the procedures, because nobody's actually said, well, it comes to intake, it does this, and so nobody's actually said it goes from point A to point B, or the steps of how it's done. Is there a form when they do intake that they say?
Right. In my understanding, depending on the severity of the illness or injury that the animal has, then they take him directly to the veterinarian. Mm-hmm. If it's a minor injury, then I'm assuming here they put him in a kennel, and then it waits to surgery examined by the veterinarian.
And how long of a process is there? Usually a couple of hours? Could it be like, if it's an intake one day, does the vet do assessment within 24 hours or whatever on all dogs coming in, or what?
I don't want to speak for the veterinary staff, but I'll take a guess, and it'll depend on their workload as well. So I can't really give you a time frame for that, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you.
According to the medical documentation on the dog, the medical history, the dog was seen the same day by the vet. It was documented what issues were with the dog. The dog was eventually fostered. It says that the dog returned on September 13th and that it was seizuring at that point in time. 9/14, they did an internal and blood work and recheck on and put it on fluconazole. October 13th, which is 30 days later, it was non-weight bearing on left forelimb. So all of the medical information had been documented. The last on here is October 13th, and that would be, like I say, when it was sent over, where we went out and issued citations. So there is a medical history.
Okay. Now I have a question with regard to that medical history. If the dog's adopted out, does that medical history go with the dog so that they go to their veterinarian, the veterinarian gets the copy of the medical history?
Once, if an animal is under foster, if something goes wrong with the animal, if we're not available, if our vets are not available, they are given permission to take it to an emergency vet. Based on that, but yes, the animal does, they are given a history of what is with this animal and what its needs are.
But is that with the adoption or with the foster?
This is foster. But, okay, but if the doctor, you said fluconazole, that's a red flag to me for valley fever. So if somebody takes this as a special needs adoption, which I'm assuming it would be, based upon the fact that there's fluconazole and there's a medical history, do they get a copy of the veterinary record to take to their vet?
Yes.
When, at the time of adoption, so they're aware of what's going on, and they can say, here's the medication, here's everything that's been done.
Anything that's a special needs adoption, if they are clearly made aware of what that animal's needs are and medical history, so that we don't want to set someone up to fail with that animal, especially with that special needs adoption. So they are advised.
Great, thank you. Okay, so are there any more welfare cases? Thank you. Okay, dangerous dogs. I have one case. There's one case in. Well, actually, I have a general comment. There are several pit bulls that are put in place. A minor is in charge of the dog, and they obviously cannot control the animal. In that case, I think the parent should be checked out. See, I don't know. It's. I need it. We need. Well, I can't say it. I mean, if you have a dog, can do damage, just like somebody with a weapon can, because a dog can be used as a weapon, as we know. And that parents have to take responsibility for their children's actions, and it doesn't. You know, so I just. It's my personal opinion, sorry guys. But I have a case on here. Yes. I understand exactly what you're saying.
No. Well, you don't know what I'm saying because I haven't said it.
Is that a lie?
I don't understand what policy we need to change. If the policy is that a 12-year-old can have a pit bull and we do nothing about it and it comes back and we do nothing about it because it's a welfare case, I'd like to know that. And I'd like to be able to discuss the policy about who can, you know, adopt or foster, and how what age, and how a 12-year-old got custody of the dog to be in the public.
I mean, in charge of it.
That's all. To me, that's the question. We should, you know, because what I heard you say is that a child. Which a child to me is a teenager or younger, had custody of a pit bull, I don't know if it was from here or elsewhere, but had came to our attention, and you're saying, we need to know why, how, and should that continue?
Okay, let me
you know, that's clarify. True, then we need to discuss it and get a report.
Let me clarify, there are a couple cases here where children or teenagers have control of pit bulls on leashes. One actually removed a leash from the pit bull and the pit bull bit someone. Mm-hmm. And I think people need to be aware of the ramifications of having a dog. I mean, even a small dog can do some damage, but a pit bull or a Rottweiler or something like that, that can do some, that's a safety issue. And my question is, how are the parents held accountable? Because if the child is walking that type of an animal and they can't control it and it goes after someone, that child could be bit as well, trying to stop it, biting or whatever. I mean, you find too many people who can't control an animal, and having a child put in that situation, I have some concerns about it, but that's...
All right, but I guess my question, what I'm understanding is that Mr. Right. Jacobs is saying, you're making an opinion, but what do you want to do?
I mean, are the parents cited in these cases, or is the minor? I mean, are they? Is when the parents have a child, say they're out walking the dog on a regular basis, a bully breed that could do some damage. When there's an incident, if there's a bite incident, who is that case turned over to perhaps social services to see if. They need to look at how that, if that child is being put in a position where the parent needs some counseling. I know that a lot of people take their children, for instance, shooting. And state law requires if your child is in the presence of a weapon and you're standing there, you still have to write a note and put it in that child's pocket that you're aware you're putting that child in a situation where there could be harm. And I have seen too many pit bulls, Rottweilers being walked without adult supervision that are not under control, and they're dragging a child.
The owner is always, the adult is the person that is always cited and responsible, because they are responsible for their juvenile.
Okay.
Yeah, but no.
Yes.
Juvenile's not cited into juvenile court?
No.
Why not?
No. We cannot issue citations to a juvenile.
Rhetorically.
That's
a rhetorical question. Did we want to put on agenda? Then we need to ask, do we put on agenda? If we can, if so, do we wish to?
We could put a lot of laws on the agenda. We have a state law that came out a couple years ago saying that if your dog attacks another dog, you have to pay for it. I mean, that's a state statute. You know, so the same thing here. If that pit bull would have attacked another dog or another child at the hospital, it's in the law. They have to pay for it. I mean, these are all the laws that we enforce.
Yeah, but that's not the question. The question was specifically, the dog is in the control. Control means a lot in the law of a pit bull. And the pit bull became dangerous. They cite the parents. My question is, do they cite the child into juvenile court? Because that may be the way to resolve what's going on.
That was asked and answered. We don't cite that.
We don't cite juveniles. We actually will not speak with
them. I understand what we don't do. My question is, why not? Why do we do it that way? Why is there another way to do it? I worked in juvenile court, and I wish that many times I had heard that the child was out with a pit bull, and the pit bull was used as a weapon. But if you don't tell me, as a juvenile probation officer, I have no way to know that. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, getting back to this, there's a case actually in October. I would like to recheck them. An English bulldog apparently was given away after it bit someone. It was transported to Mexico. On the report, the investigation report, it says the dog is licensed. In the officer's report, it says that the owner vaccinated the animal himself in Mexico. I've always understood that a veterinarian had to be the person giving the rabies vaccination, and you had to show proof of it in order to get a rabies vaccination. And so, a license. But in the report here, it says that the animal is licensed. The officer's written statement say, the owner says he got the vaccines in Mexico, did it himself. So,
May be when the dog first came into the United States. Mm-hmm. I don't know, but I can tell you that if our licensing department licensed this dog, which it shows a current license for 2015, that this dog had the documentation that was sufficient to prove that it was currently an acceptable vaccination.
Because this did not show that in the
that did not, but so by the license itself, we know that they check and they enter it into the computer.
So here's another procedure, sorry about this.
Okay.
On these investigation reports, if it says it's licensed, it's checked, all these are checked by licensing to make sure they're verified in the system that they are licensed and it's correct.
Through the chameleon system, they can do that, and they can actually see the section that says when the vaccination was given and what vet gave it.
Thank you. You're not doing anything. Thank you, sir. Any more cases?
I just wanted to talk to the committee about a couple of things. One is, after last month's meeting, a few questions came from some of the volunteers about the management report that comes out with all the financials attached to it, and that financial report has historically been and continues to be generated by Kim James. Mm-hmm. And I sat down with him to try to understand where he was getting the numbers from, because I talked with Kristen, she didn't understand where he was getting the numbers from. I talked to our finance department, they didn't really understand how the report was generated. So what I'm going to propose is that I work with our finance department, who actually monitors our budget and stuff, and create a report that actually I can speak to and understand, because that one, I really couldn't answer the questions. I know some came from you, Mr. Newman, and one of them was just a formula, so that was easy to figure out. But as far as how all the other numbers go and where they're getting pulled from, they don't really match any of the other things in the county system. So I would rather give this committee a report that I can speak to, our finance department can speak to. So that's my proposal moving forward. And I have a meeting in 2 weeks set up with our finance officer who runs our budget to work out a report that we can get on a monthly basis. Normally they do a quarterly report. So we're trying to figure out something they can generate for us monthly to bring.
Do we want monthly or quarterly? I mean, do we want to see if it's readily available, or do you guys still want to try to generate the monthly report or quarterly, as you said?
I'd like it monthly, as long as it's usually those numbers are going to be at hand. Yeah, right there with you, because you have them on an A2 basis. So they could just, once they plug in those numbers, and then they could just generate the report.
Okay. Thank you. The two other things I wanted to talk about. One is, if you haven't heard, our adoptions coordinator, Andrew, accepted another position with the libraries. Volunteer. What did I say?
Adoption.
I'm sorry. Volunteer coordinator. Andrew accepted another position with the libraries, Pima County Library System. And so he's already had his last day. We posted the position. It just recently closed. We have our pool of certified applicants that they'll be interviewing in the next couple of weeks. And from what I've heard, they have some really good candidates they're excited about. So as soon as that position is filled, I'll update the committee and bring that volunteer coordinator.
Who is interviewing him? Is there a committee of individuals interviewing that person?
Right. It's a county process, how it always works. We have to have a committee that has to have male, female on it, has to have a supervisor, has to have the supervisor that's reporting, that position's reporting, and an EEO, the equal county officer in the room.
Okay, so there's, can you force it, there's not like shelter staff, somebody for shelter staff, or?
I don't know who the committee is. That would be up to Kristen.
Okay,
to determine who's on
just,
the,
I was just curious.
Oh, thank you. Okay. Yeah, it's whatever division that's in, we let them decide who's on the committee.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. And then the last thing is, I just wanted to give an update on the Pima County Attorney coming to the meeting. They weren't available this month. They had a lot going on with some other ordinances and stuff that they're working on. So she can come to the January meeting and speak to the issue of the holds and the bonds and the hold times at PAC. So I'll have her on the agenda for the January meeting.
Okay. Thank you. Ms. Jane?
Mr. Jacobs also suggested that the a judge from the Justice Court or an or administrator from the Justice Court be invited to come also.
We can invite them. I talked to the county attorney about that, and she said it's highly, highly unlikely that they'll come to one of these committee meetings, that if this committee makes a recommendation to the Board of Supervisors would then give them communication that they could potentially act on or listen to, but they don't come to community committees.
So the county attorney is coming in at our January meeting?
Yes.
Would you be able to tell ahead of time what our concern is?
I already have, yeah.
Oh, good. That's good. It's about the concerns that you have.
Okay. Anything else?
No, that's all I have.
Okay. As you know, our bylaws say we end at 7. I am going to continue if we're going to have a quorum. I understand some people need to go, but we do have some very important issues here, so I am going to keep moving forward. Is everybody else in concurrent or concurrence? I need to know if we're still going to have a quorum.
I'll be here.
Old business procedures to related agenda items. That's from Nishwari and me, and I think it was just anybody can ask to have something on the agenda. That was addressed the last time, so I think we can take that off the agenda now. Okay, we have a proposed, Mr. Garcia?
He did have to leave for a call. He's still here.
Okay, the proposal related to licensing fees. We went over a lot of this already. I have some comments. The licensing fees? Yeah, there's, I'm gonna put my two cents in here. One of the things that the committee did when we went over this the last couple times, we were pushing to make sure that unaltered animals did not get a break. And I have been informed by some very knowledgeable people in the service industry, if you have a true service animal, that animal is altered because you do not want an intact male or an unaltered female that could be interfered with if it's that. So I think that if a person wants a service animal license for free, that we should also add the word altered in there. It's necessary. Ms. Middleton.
The only time we make an exception to that is if somebody has a service dog that has been, the vet says there's a specific reason they cannot, for example, anesthetize the dog to do the surgery because they did something else and came into a problem. But I think we've got one out of 144 teams that was not altered.
Okay,
and that's covered under five.
Yes.
That's covered.
So that's already covered.
Right. So that is covered. And then there again, too, if there is an active police dog, working police dog, I think that that would, that's not a problem. Because that's, I do have a question for people on this committee that are more knowledgeable, that have had law enforcement experience. That's only a police dog, correct? That's not like a security dog or something like that? It's a sheriff's or a police officer's dog, correct?
Or corrections?
Border patrol? Any legal law enforcement. All of that is got by the government versus a private security firm.
Thank you for clarifying that for me. So I'm asking that in number seven, that the altered be in order to get a service, and I guess we could say unless it's under five, but it's covered. Thank you. Okay. Any other comments on that?
Number seven, we might need to put in the word altered. In there twice, an altered dog training to be a service animal, but maybe we don't need it in there, just the first place, an altered service animal for number seven. And then about number two,
Does it say service animal or dog, Jane?
Service animal. It says service animal or a dog,
but we don't like
training to be a service animal is what it says.
The only service animals accepted by ABA are dogs and miniature horses.
And you don't want to say
a horse. You don't license horses either, so it should say dog.
It should say dog.
So it would be a service dog?
Service dog.
Not animal, but so an animal should be changed to dog?
That should be changed to dog.
So it should be an altered service dog?
Yes.
Well, isn't there some therapy cats out there?
That's not a service.
And
you don't have a license. And we don't have. Yeah. Okay, any other comments on here?
Number. What's number five? It's listed as number five here, upon showing a veterinarian certificate, stating that a dog cannot be altered for health reasons, the regular altered dog fee will apply. Well, I oppose that because I've known of some veterinarians who just write a certificate stating that mm-hmm. they will. A whole lot of pit bulls stating that the dog could not be altered. Mm-hmm. And the veterinarian wrote a certificate saying that, mm-hmm. when they could have been altered. So I think that this number five should be just stricken out completely.
Okay. can I also amend that? Based upon your comments, we could say, we could add this portion down under seven, that an exception to a service dog with this, then they can get it at the unalt, or the altered fee.
I'm trying to ask for a vote.
Okay.
We're not finished discussing it.
We can need a motion to discuss it.
I take her comment as a motion, she wanted one restriction.
We had a discussion.
We haven't had a discussion.
Okay, then how can I discuss if I don't get a motion that I can discuss?
Okay. Is there a motion on the floor to discuss? Are you making a motion, Jane, to strike number, I guess it would be five? Five from the proposed ordinance.
Okay, I move that we strike number five.
Do I have a second? Or discuss it? No second?
No second.
Well, I'll second.
Okay, so you're second at discussion? Mr. Jacobs?
Well, I just gave a reason. Veterinarians will sign, some veterinarians will sign a certificate saying the dog cannot be altered when it could be altered.
I'll come to the defense of veterinarian. I have found them to be honest, truthful, and wise. And I don't question their veracity.
There may be a definition to tell you why the dog can't be altered. The vet
will say, have to tell you why it can't be altered.
In writing.
I have a hard time not believing what the vets, I have a hard time thinking the vets would have lied. And just give us, I'm sorry, but I just have a hard time believing that.
I'm a vet, all right. I would say that 99.9% of them are perfectly honest. I know that as in every profession or walk of life, there are dishonest people, and we have had personal experiences with those, and I, you know, but I don't think that we should omit that just because there are some very few rotten apples in the barrel.
Yeah, with regard to this, could we make an amendment that said this has to be reaffirmed annually? I don't know. I mean, if you take your animal in annually for your physical, if the vet says this animal still cannot be altered, it's one thing, but they may say the animal may be altered at this time. So I'm saying maybe a minute.
But in my opinion, it could be qualified as to require supporting documentation as to the medical condition that would prohibit the procedure. I have experience with veterinarians who basically will not anesthetize anything that's over 10 years old, and that's really, in my opinion, not a valid reason not to do a procedure. You would want a validated medical reason not to anesthetize the patient, so that might, in my opinion, be fair.
It says, upon showing a veterinarian certificate stating that, the certificate is not good.
Well, a certificate is a
stainer
certificate, right?
No, this is a certificate stating that the dog cannot be altered. It would have to be a special certificate stating that the dog cannot be altered.
Right, so I don't even know what a certificate like that would look like, but I can make
one. How about that?
And like say what the medical condition is on the certificate, if there actually is one.
That's what I've
never seen.
And
I think we just created one.
Yes.
I asked the minute, but asked the county to create it.
Yeah.
And it looks like it's done in place of dogs 10 years of age or older. And and I happen to believe that dogs 10 years of age or older don't need a lot of vaccinations. I'm not sure about rabies. I'll have a question on that one.
Okay, so we need to have a vote on...
We need a motion.
So...
Well, there was a motion.
No, I think we need the motion a second. Yeah.
We have a second on the motion to...
Let's call for the question.
Jane's motion was that she wanted this struck. We had discussions, so do we...
Call for the motion.
Call for the motion.
Call for the vote.
I said for the vote, we said we needed a motion. The motion was, do we wish to strike number five upon showing veterinarian certificate stating that a dog cannot be altered for health reasons, the regular unaltered dog fee, the dog license fee should apply.
Altered dog fee for an animal that's not altered?
Yeah. With a certificate. Instead of certificate, the certificate's confusing.
Why don't we have documentation?
Unaltered is unaltered.
I think you want to say certificate because then the 1% can't lie.
Well, no, we're not changing things. What we have to do is vote on whether we're striking it or not.
Okay, so we have a motion before. All those in favor of striking five? All those against?
So it's one to ten.
I'm not comfortable with some of the writing on this. I'd like to see.
So you want to strike five?
Yeah, I would. The wording, I don't like how it's worded, so.
Did you know?
That's not the issue.
But that's not the issue.
That's not the issue.
The issue was striking it. Now, if you're not comfortable.
If you're not comfortable, say what it is. If you're not comfortable with, make a motion. We'll discuss it and then we'll vote on it.
Well, excuse me, what was the vote we just took?
The vote was eight to two.
On five.
To strike it off. It was eight to two. We're not striking. Eight to two.
Ninety-two.
Ninety-two.
It failed.
It failed.
For the record, the new number four, I still oppose. Thank you.
You oppose, what is holding up now?
What is, okay.
It doesn't have the old lady, it changes, you know. So that.
The striking the old number four?
The old number four and substitute, and I still oppose the new number four. No motion.
Okay. So, you know, I'm just going to say that. So we have, okay, did you have your?
No, I'm waiting for the next. Next item. Next item. Are we done with this?
Okay, no, we need to.
Do you want another motion?
We need a motion on actually to pass the ordinances with the amended changes.
I move to pass the motion with the amended changes.
Second.
Okay, discussion?
Yeah, discussion. I have a change to make. I discussed this with Tim James. He said it should be sent to the county attorney. But I'll give you copies. If you all want copies of there, I'll just tell you very briefly. All right, I'll read it to you. It's the first part, 6.04.050, which says, animal care enforcement officers are authorized to enforce the provisions of this chapter and to issue citations for violations of this chapter. And that is, it's not complete and it needs to have some changes. And so I have added not only the animal care enforcement officer, but also any peace officer. And I,
would you read it how you've written it, please, Jane?
Okay. Any peace officer or any animal care enforcement officer is authorized and empowered to enforce any of the provisions of this Title VI. It's not the chapter, but it's Title VI. Including, but not limited to, the issuing of criminal and civil citations for violations and civil infractions thereof, the issuing of notices in connection with civil procedures such as 6.04.140 and 6.05.040, and the removing and impounding of animals. And going on to paragraph B, fines received for such violations and civil infractions and penalty fees shall be deposited in a special permanent non-lapsing.
Is this stuff you've just written or are you adding to this?
This is stuff she's written.
Okay, thank you.
No, I'm changing.
I'm changing and adding to it. I've got copies, but Kim Jane suggested Ms. Barnes
Flanagan,
that this should be sent to the county attorney. And if it's in any, I can pass around if anybody wants to see what it's in.
Mr. Jenkins?
There's no motion, there's no action by this. I don't want to see it. I'll do it in a moment. I'd like to finish my cup. Yeah, there's no motion, and there's no specific language, and we're not able to discuss it. Well, let me finish. Okay, what's the motion? I'll shut up.
The motion was, do we wish to pass this ordinance with the amendments we made tonight? And the discussion was, she said she had some more changes. So I said, were there any more changes?
When you make them, when I made the motion and it was seconded, you can't
change it.
You can't just change my motion and say, here's some more stuff, by the way. And that just quashes the motion. So I understand what he's saying. You have to vote on my motion. All right. The motion
you can
was,
withdraw.
Or I can withdraw. The motion was that we pass this specific animal control regulations as designated with the changes we have here now. That was seconded. And then we had discussion. Now, discussion normally means, I don't like it, I like it, I think we need to make more changes, I think we need to add more. Okay, fine, you need to add more, you can pass it off. But still, we still have to vote on my motion.
Motion.
You have the right to add, to make a motion that we would vote on before we vote on it from that.
No. Well, then that would be up to the chair to amend
the motion. There are procedures to do it. She can make a motion to amend his motion first, if she wishes.
She should do that.
All right, well, discussion. I move to amend your motion to include the changes that I have written out here.
Can I move to the
It has to be seconded.
I'll second.
That we need to have, it needs to be seen by the county attorney.
I don't have any more copies of these.
It's all right.
I have to be sure.
Madam Chairman? Has the county attorney approved as to form and language the proposal we have before us?
Yes.
Yes.
County attorney's not here to defend their language, therefore, I would be voting no.
What are you voting on?
Well, on her motion.
Since we're discussing additional language, when you read the animal care enforcement officers are authorized to enforce the provisions of this chapter, they're not saying or excluding anybody else. That's all they're saying is that these particular officers can enforce when they're authorized. It doesn't say to the exclusion of any other officers. So by adding language, you can do that. It clarifies it more. But this language by itself should take care of the issue.
It does not.
Madam Chair? Okay, yes.
Concern I have is where you get down to talking Title VI, including but not limited to, such as 6.04.140 and 6.05.040 is not needed.
It's not
so we really cannot be concerned about that at this point.
Can we vote on the initial motion?
Okay,
You have to vote on her motion first.
It hasn't been seconded yet.
Yes, it was.
I
wouldn't have discussed it with anyone in a second.
Okay.
Can we vote on ensuring?
A call for the vote.
A call for the vote, yeah.
You don't even want to read it before you vote on it?
You read it?
Could you write it?
Well,
I have other little argument that I added to it.
Well, call for the vote on Ms. Schwerin's.
Okay, I'd like a chance to discuss it. And just discussing it is just to explain further why we need it.
It's your problem.
Okay. Can we make it quick? We've got 15 minutes to get through the rest of the agenda.
The way it's written is not complete. And it's a good idea to put the, and it's, it, this may be, the way I have it may be to duplicate some other parts of the ordinance of the whole Pima County Code. But it's desirable to have the whole story all in one place. So you don't have a little piece here and a little piece 10 pages later and a little piece 10 pages later. I have pulled it all together and put it all in one place. And also I have added some new and good thoughts too, such as it should be a peace officer may do this as well as any animal care officer. And it should be the whole Title VI, not just this chapter. I have improved it. And I think the county attorney will approve it, will approve of it.
Dr. Smith,
does the county attorney have to see that before we put it in here?
Yes.
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 My thought is, should that be sent to the county attorney rather than rewrite this, have the county attorney check the language first before we put it in? Or do you want to put it in instead? Is that what you're saying? You want to put it in no matter what?
No, I wouldn't put it in the county attorney. Like, I thought what Kim James said is that you should send it to the county attorney.
So, we'll send it to the county attorney.
She can send it to the county attorney. And I'm not voting for it.
Right, so.
Because I don't think the lady does what she says.
We haven't even read it. And
what do you mean I didn't read it? Did I read it?
Okay, let's put it
in. Yes,
okay, or no? Okay. Guys, voting on the motion.
Which one?
Okay.
The motion to amend comes first. Then on the basic
motion. All those in favor for amending using Ms. Schwerin's changes this time. That's what we're talking about. All in favor? All against? Opposed? Okay. One abstain, two, whatever.
James, the only one who was for?
Yeah. Nine against was.
Nine against.
Now do we go back? After we go back to the original?
And who abstained?
Okay.
Call for the motion on the original motion. Call for the vote.
Call for the vote on the original motion. All those in favor of sending forward?
I amend
this.
With you.
All those in favor putting through what the committee has without the language that the attorney has reviewed with the minutes. Jeff, thank you.
Okay. The motion is that we, I already forgot myself. The motion is that we, I make a motion that we pass the document before us with the changes that we made on 5. And that's it.
Seven.
That's it.
And that's what was seconded. So the vote, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Those against? Those abstain?
Sorry.
Okay. No.
8-3 and the 3 were...
I have a suggestion. Yes,
okay,
Dr. Sophia? My suggestion is, and we can make a motion if we want to or not, but my suggestion is that what Ms. Schwerin proposed be submitted to the county attorney for a review, and if they choose to include it, then you know, they can do that.
Is that
so
motion?
That's a
is that motion?
And I second it.
Yes. Discussion? All those in favor?
Yeah.
Unanimous.
No.
One, all those against one. Okay. Thank you. Okay, now.
Should I say that about an hour?
Okay. All right. There's a proposed amendment to the Pima County Code. We're considering the advisory committee. Ms. Flanagan?
Okay. Ms. Newman, members of the committee. The Pima County attorney worked with the county administrator's office. Oh, I did. I'm sorry.
Yeah, sorry.
We were going to bring that.
The county attorney worked with Ms. Lesher to revise and with input from the board supervisors, how this committee is formed, how the members are appointed by the board supervisors, similar to our board of health. And then left it up to the committee then to write the bylaws or to amend the current bylaws that will then go to the board of supervisors for approval. So this is the draft of that.
This is our vote or just an FYI?
This, we would like to hear your feedback and your input. And if you're in support of it, that would be wonderful. And if you have comments that you want me to take back and make note of, we can absolutely do that as well.
Ms. Mendelson?
I have a question. In membership of community B1, are we eliminating our positions? Because here on the front page of the old one,
right,
it's completely gone from the back page of the second one.
Right, so all the current committee members' terms would expire in like a rolling calendar. Some would expire in June of this year, others not until June of 2017, others in June of 2018. I think there's one or two that would be 2019.
Right, but this basically says that there is no position. The position is gone. That's what I was asking about.
What position? I'm sorry.
Like disabled community.
Oh, correct. Yes, you're correct. Yes, you're correct.
Being kicked off. Can I clarify something? Mercy, if it's the like the Humane Society, my position is up this in 2016, which is this coming
June,
right? So, if my position were, if I were to be one going to go off on in 2018, would that mean the Humane Society still on there?
The current committee members would stay until their term is up and then be replaced by the Board of Supervisors appointees.
Okay.
Dr.
Smith.
One question is why, and why would you not want to have people on this committee who are from the animal welfare community? Because when you look at the people they want to put on this board, except for the people from PAC, Friends of PAC and CAUSE, you don't have anybody from the animal welfare community. And everybody here has the animals up front. Otherwise, you're having politicians selecting people to sit on this committee.
Correct. What would
happen is that the board of supervisors from their districts, much like they do with the Board of Health, would pick individuals in their districts that have animal welfare, either experience, knowledge, investment, in that it's highly unlikely they're just going to pick a random person out of their, they're going to approach their constituents within their district about who has a stake in animal welfare.
Well, why not have them, in addition to the TAP committee made larger, and have these people come in, but keep the people here who know animal rights and animal care. The people here live and breathe animal welfare. And that's part of what PAC is all about. How can you have these people not be on this committee? I just cannot fathom this committee without the people who care for animals so much to not be on it.
And I have some concerns too, because by having partners from the organizations or the communities that have IGAs, one of my main concerns is that the programs that have made such strides in the past several years, like Pet Fix or different programs, they're going to look at the donations, they're going to say those need to go into offsetting administrative costs, and we're going to see the loss of some of the ground we've made. And that's my personal concern, because we have seen what we're also going to be talking about shortly, that the IGA, so there have been two partners that have been concerned about funding that was intended for the animals to offset the IGA. And so this is, I'm concerned about that.
Much like in this capacity, though, it would be recommendations that go to the Board of Supervisors. So the committee, whether there was jurisdiction representatives or not, they would only be making recommendations to the Board of Supervisors, and it would be the Board of Supervisors' determination of how our donations are allotted, how those jurisdictional contracts work, and how they're approved.
Okay, well, one of the things we were told with regard to the communities that have IGAs is that they were working with Mr. Gates, because we had recommended the city of Tucson, their slot had been, their position had been vacant for so long that perhaps it should be removed. And they said, no, they still wanted it. And then other people said, we want places in this as well. And at that time, we were told that Mr. James was going to be working with them. And so an alternative to some of this might be that there is an IGA committee that oversees some of this, and they see it from the perception of the budget and the relations with Health and Human Services and the animals, and that they have maybe two members sit on this board, but they have a separate committee that has representation. Just like we've got a member of the Board of Health here. It's because most of us here are concerned about what's going on in this facility and the enforcement and health and human safety as well as the animals. But we've had some people that it's the bottom line's a dollar, and we don't want to lose the programs we've done. And having the IGAs here, that person may be knowledgeable or they may not be knowledgeable on the laws and the welfare. And when people are giving donations for the animals, we want to make sure that the spirit of the giving continues and that it is kept in line. So that's my personal opinion. So, Ms. Heather.
I have a question for you. What I just heard you say, even if we had five jurisdictions on the PACAC committee, the final decision is up to the Board of Supervisors.
Correct. Okay. Great. And there's only one, actually, from the jurisdiction that would be recognized.
No, but the point is, they're not going to outvote us.
Correct.
Just because they want the money, it's going that has to go before the Board of Supervisors.
Correct.
And secondly, just from working for a nonprofit, and I understand this isn't a nonprofit, sometimes you meet people on your boards and your committees that are lawyers and are finance people. You know, you need a diverse, you need diversity. So,
Dr. Garcia, I'm going to break procedure and ask for your feedback.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to address the committee, and I want to sort of give you a little bit of context, and I apologize, I was in the other room on a conference call, and so I don't know what some of this, whether you have some of this context or not. So the county attorney's office has been looking at all the county's boards and commissions with an eye toward how representative they are of the jurisdictions and how politically accountable they are. And the county attorney's office has determined that across all the different boards and commissions, and I believe that we operate something like 20-some boards and commissions, that we need to have some degree of uniformity. The other thing that the county attorney determined was that the current ordinance, as it was constituted, as it was crafted, probably no longer made sense in the fact that some of the entities didn't actually exist anymore. And so the county attorney's office, along with myself, along with Ms. Lesher, started the process of thinking what might the alternatives look like. Priority number one was to not lose the historical knowledge that this group has, because you build that over a long period of time. And so that's why you see this as being something that's rolled out over a 3-year period. Because the goal isn't to kick anybody off. The goal is to provide a new infusion of other voices at the table. So that was priority number one. Priority number two was to make sure that in the same way that other boards and commissions are accountable and and responsive to the specific needs of the districts that they represent, that this one also did that to a certain extent, because currently there was no such ability to do that. So the last thing that I will share with you is when we think about how we implement this, one of the things, and as we've had conversations with individual members of the Board of Supervisors, one of the things that we have assembled is a table that says, this is who you are, this is your current supervisory district, and part of our duty to the Board of Supervisors, whether it's Chairman Bronson or Vice Chair Elias, will be to provide a listing of the current members of the PAC Act who currently reside from their the supervisory district. And then they will do whatever process they want to do to decide who it is that they're going to select. It is unlikely, in my humble opinion, it is unlikely that, for instance, the other major animal welfare agency will not be represented in some form or fashion. It's just not politically likely. So I don't think that that's gonna. I don't think that that's gonna happen. I do think that. I do think that you will see. The goal is to potentially bring in some new faces with some additional skill sets. So there, it will be a single jurisdictional representative. There won't be five. There will be a single jurisdictional representative from, and there will be a single county administrator. No, did I get that wrong? Okay,
so there's the Board of Supervisors each appoint.
Right, the Board of Supervisors each appoint one.
Oh, right, so that's
right.
Five.
There's five, and then there's a single jurisdictional representative,
yes.
And there's a single representative designated by the county administrator, two designated by the county administrator,
one staff
as well
and one.
As one staff and one appointee, as well as the Friends of PAC,
right,
and the
Sapma.
Southern
Arizona. Yes, the veterinarians. Right.
And it's a PAC and the volunteers.
Mr. Neiman. Excuse me.
Jane. He's got the.
It says here.
Jane. He was recognized first. He was already talking. Yeah.
The question I have is a little unclear on the representation from the incorporated areas. Like, is there, like, let me ask the question this way. Is there one from Tucson, is and another one from Sarita, and another
no.
one from...
No.
So they come together and they select
yes.
one.
Yes.
So what we've done, so... It does say that a single representative of the partner jurisdiction.
Yeah. No, that's the one representative of each... Of the jurisdiction.
The PAC partner jurisdictions is a separate committee that is constituted by one representative from each of the separate jurisdictions. It's not part PAC. Separate and apart from PAC, we have a PAC partners jurisdiction.
That sentence is describing PAC partners, not who's appointed to
right.
this.
So that is a group that meets on a quarterly basis, that meets with the county administrator, the deputy county administrator, myself, and the chief of operations at PAC, and they, you know, share their thoughts and critiques with us. And from that group, they will be tasked with identifying a single representative that would serve on this committee.
Madam Chairman?
Yes,
please. I'm reading looks to be on page number 12, page 204, paragraph B. So it's community organizations and partners. Follows membership of this committee consists of the following. And right going down through it. Southern Arizona Veterinary Medical Association. That's a position. Correct.
That's one. Yes.
All right. Pima Animal Care. Partner, that's position.
Well, right, and then it says comma, and it says what that is comprised of, which is comprised of one representative of each of the jurisdictions. If you see, that's a comma, that's not the semicolon that's separating each appointed member. Do you see that? Right.
That's what I'm trying to get to.
Yes, there's
correct.
Okay, well, the partners,
It says which is comprised of.
If one representative, they have intergovernmental agreements with Pima County.
Right.
All right. Now, does that include Tucson and Sarita? They have intergovernmental agreements with it.
Okay, so you're still, so where it says the Pima Animal Care Center's partners, which is comprised of one representative of each of the jurisdictions that have an intergovernmental agreement with Pima County. It's describing what that.
Yeah, we don't know who they all are, but they don't have one.
There's obviously one.
Plus the Friends of Pima County will have a position.
Correct.
Plus the non-funding arm of PAC.
No, that's just describing Friends of PAC. That's just describing Friends of PAC. That's a comma.
Okay.
And the volunteers.
And then the Friends. That's more than the comma.
Yes.
Volunteers. So there's four positions, B.
Yes.
Plus all those appointed by the board.
Plus five that'll come from the board supervisors and two from the county administrators. One staff and one of them.
Okay, when you're talking about the kids, the staff is like the reporting secretary, what is that?
No, they're turning that into member.
Okay. Okay, so that with that kind of. Because it was like, I just was assuming like 16 people and it's like.
It would be 11. The same number.
If I could add one final comment. Part of the challenge that we were given by the county attorney's office is to not sort of pick winners and losers in the process. That being more of a political decision. The politicians can pick the winners and losers in terms of what organizations they want to have represented or not represented. So that's part of the reason why this one doesn't specifically include things like a member of the disabled community, somebody involved in education, precisely because those determinations were going to be left up to the individual members of the Board of Supervisors.
Okay, while we're talking about this, the terms is confusing as all heck, okay? Because you start, it's like on one set you say, well, like, this person's appointed for 2 years, this person's appointed for 4 years. How is that going to be determined or whatever? So I was like.
So one of the things that, Madam Chair, one of the things that happens, for instance, in nonprofit boards is as you're trying to bring in new folks, again, with an interest of not losing a lot of history, is to kind of start people on staggered terms. And in fact, some of those folks might have shorter terms. And then when their term is up, then they would be up for the regular 4-year term.
So.
But that would be a reappointment. So if Supervisor Bronson decided to appoint Mrs. McGillicuddy, and she is filling one of her slots, and she would be appointed for a period of time. At the end of that period of time, Supervisor Bronson or whomever sits as a representative of that supervisory district would have the option of either reappointing the same individual or identifying a new one.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that. Mr. Jacobs.
I just want to make sure that I don't misrepresent, but what I heard and how what I saw is we are now making membership beyond the four positions we just described political. Appointees.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Okay. Are we not really appointed right now?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You're representative organizations.
They approved it.
This board made recommendations of what organizations were represented on the board.
It's a major change to have an organization say, we want John Smith. We recommend John Smith, and then they get approved as opposed to the Board of Supervisors saying, who lives in my district that I think I would like to have on that board?
Yes.
That's a political decision. It has nothing to do with the organization. Are the interests that we now represent. I understand that. It's a government position, and the government can.
So, we're done discussing this?
construct it to where we want.
Well, I'm sure I'm opposed to this.
Getting rid of all of it.
I agree with what Dr. Smith said. There's an effort made to get rid of everybody who cares about animals.
Okay, so do we want to continue further discussion? Do we want to hold this as the vote? Do we have a motion to vote on this? This is basically a courtesy. So,
right, if there's information that you want me to
the vote is not going to have much effect. It's going to be proposed forward. But
it would be advisory.
Right. Okay. So, do I have a motion to make a vote on the stance of the committee as a whole to be forwarded to?
I'll try to make a motion, but it's probably going to be a personalized, my opinion, obviously. I believe change is always good. You know, anytime we have change, we make it good. So what we have now is good, but maybe what we can have in the future is better. I don't know. But I'm for at least giving it a try. A lot of staff time and effort went into talking about this and deciding how to do this. We've had historically we've had issues in PAC, and in the last couple of years, I've seen huge improvement happening. So personally, if this is what the staff is recommending, I'm all for it. I would like to make a motion that we tell the staff, yes, we agree with what you're doing. And that's just my personal opinion. Actually, it's not. It's my professional opinion.
I second.
Okay.
I'm going to oppose the motion because, number one, I think I've had 4 days to digest it, as you see by my questions. I clearly didn't understand it. So. There'll be questions today. Secondly, I think the community needs to know in advance, before we vote, that so they have an opportunity to come and talk to us. There may be members of the community that want to come in and say, we don't want a political advisory committee when it comes to the welfare. Can I finish?
Yes,
I didn't say a word when I spoke.
Yeah, you were very kind.
Thank you. And they haven't had the chance. Thank you.
This was on the board supervisors. I mean, I pulled all this off the minute it was put up on the website, so anybody from the public has access to this.
This information is also on PAC's website.
Yeah, okay, it is on the county website. Right?
Yeah. I didn't say that. And I understand we met with
the... Well, I thought you were saying that the public didn't have an opportunity to see this.
No, I'm assuming that they did, but I didn't have enough time to make appropriate calls and notifications of the people who I represent so that they could come and speak if they wish to, or they could speak to me so I could vote knowing what they say.
Okay, let me ask this one something. We can move forward our recommendation. When this goes forward, this will actually, before the board of supervisors, correct, this will be in an open meeting for public input. That they will hear before they take action from any members of the public there speaking up about it, because this was basically a courtesy that we received this paperwork. And so the body that is going to be, in my opinion, getting the greatest impact from public input is the Board of Supervisors when this comes up for a vote. But at this time, we're supposed to be providing our opinion, feedback.
So we
support it or not. Dr. Smith?
Can I amend Pat Hubbard's motion? To amend for the county to consider enlarging the advisory committee and adding the people that they suggested, but keeping the animal welfare people on the committee. Instead of replacing the animal welfare committee, the animal welfare people, add the five people from the county supervisors appointment, add Mr. Huckleberry's two people, and add the people that are listed in paragraph one, enlarge the committee to keep the animal welfare people here. That would be how I would change, that's how I would amend the motion.
Do I have a second?
Second for discussion.
Discussion? Discussion? We have a second?
All right. I can discuss it. In the past, Mr. Huckleberry has made some terrible suggestions. I think at one time he suggested that one of his suggestions was that people dropping off animals at the animal care center should be charged, you have to pay a fee. Was Huckleberry?
Yes, it was.
Yes, it was. That's the kind of thing you want to invite two of these people on this committee?
Well, yeah, as long as we're still here too.
Oh, no.
Oh, we won't be here.
What?
All of us people.
Oh.
Well, I don't think I'm not in favor of having a lot of those, some of those people on here who don't care about animals.
We're still in discussion?
Yes.
That was discussion.
On the amendment.
We're discussing the amendment. Well, I work, as everybody knows, I work with Humane Society, and we are partners with PAC. We have been for years and years, and while maybe there hasn't always been, it's not always been on the same table, we've always been able to approach one another through the organization. And I think to critique Mr. Huckleberry like that, there are many, many organizations in this country, and I know he did his research, that do ask for intake fees. Mm-hmm. So to turn your back on Mr. Huckleberry because of the intake fee situation, I totally disagree with that. It's not about it. This whole discussion is not about whether we're charging intake fees or not. It's about whether we're going to go on, this committee is going to be agreeable one way or another with what's on the agenda.
Everything I said is right on the point.
Pardon?
What I said is right on the point.
That's maybe your opinion, but right now we need to talk about this document. And I feel that if we add the people that the county and attorney think should be on this committee, but keep the animal welfare people in addition, make the committee larger, like at least we'll have the people who have animal rights first and foremost on the committee. We don't have to worry. You don't have to worry.
But we have voted.
Madam Chair.
Mr. Jacobs.
I would interpret this to say that we in the animal community are now going to have to be politically aware, politically astute, and be forceful in our position in a political way with the Board of Supervisors and the County Administration. Fine with me, but you have changed our position as being here to assist and help in the best we can to those of another political entity for the board to consider. Thank you.
Okay, so we have an amendment.
Call for the vote on the amendment.
We have a call for vote on the. Okay, we're calling for a vote on the amendment, which is all
which is to add.
Add recommendation. Rather than replace. Okay, so call on the motion. All those in favor? To add the animal welfare people rather than replace. Or we're add the new people rather than replace the animal welfare, so in other words, the largest committee. Okay, and all those opposed to enlarging this committee and replacing. It's about enlarging the committee. Okay, all those opposed. Those abstain? Four?
The opposed were Jane, Pat Hubbard, Pat Jacobs, and Dr. O.
Okay.
And so abstained was Mr. Marshall.
Dr. Sophia.
Dr. Sophia.
Okay, even less Tammy.
Tammy and Helen.
That's much.
And Jack just, and yeah, and you didn't vote either, right? Or, and Jack didn't vote. He went here.
Yeah, so.
Well, I mean, the motion failed.
Now, for the original motion.
Pat's motion. Pat, you want a motion?
Again?
Again.
I've said so much already. I think that we need to let the county know that we're supporting them. They have been supporting the shelter, they've been supporting everything we've been doing. And I think that they put a lot of time and effort working with this. And yes, I'm going to tell them that as a committee, we agree that change can be good.
That's what it was. Okay, all those in favor? All those opposed? All those who abstain?
I'm Mary.
I'll twerk back.
I can't read everybody's. So, four was Pat Hubbard and Jack. Against was Dr. Smith, Jane, Pat Jacobs, and Helen.
I'm confused.
And confused? No, I mean abstained. Dr. S. You were abstained, right? Mr. Marshall. And apparently Nancy.
Yeah.
I'm just.
Nancy. And Tim.
No categories were confused.
Confused.
Madam Chair, I ask to be recognized. Okay. Make a motion. I move that we thank the Board of Supervisors for providing us the opportunity to discuss this matter. Period.
Second it?
Wait, I didn't hear that. I'm sorry.
Can we just thank them for the opportunity to discuss?
Discuss this matter.
Second.
Okay, discussion.
Well, it was, it's a courtesy. We could be courteous back, number one. And just, and I'd like to explain.
Okay. Yes.
I do not think we have time to kick us all up.
And Mark, all those in favor?
Aye.
And opposed was Jane and.
Jane and Jane, okay.
Were you opposed then?
Jane, okay. Now. Okay, one more thing. Okay, so those of you who will leave, we have, but we're going to discuss, Dr. Garcia is here to discuss the donations. And I'm so sorry.
That's okay. Actually, Caravelle is just going to lead the presentation. Last time, Madam Chair and members of the committee, last time that you met, there was a lot of questions and a lot of really good positive interest in what exactly it was that we were doing on the fundraising side of the house, because it's gotten us some decent attention. The other thing that has happened since the last time that we met, you saw that there were some public conversations on the part of some of the jurisdictions about how we've decided to use some of those resources. So at the request of the chair and at the request of the committee, we want to provide you kind of like a little overview of where we are in terms of our fundraising program. And then specifically, I want to sort of address the, And then I want to address specifically the Rasmussen First and Trust dollars and programmatically why it is that we see them as different from other types of donations, because that was the question that was raised.
Before Karen starts her presentation, I just have one question.
Yes.
And to me, it's a critical question.
Okay.
Is any of this going to affect and impact Spaniard?
Yes.
The county's going to pull back money on Spangler?
Chairman Emptage, Ms. Hubbard, we have made a programmatic investment in spay and neuter that is unprecedented. Under my direction and for the foreseeable future, while I'm in the current position, we will continue to invest in spay and neuter. We have to invest in spay and neuter. We want to share with you how we're framing it, though, because you know, the devil's in the details. But no, we're not going back from spay and neuter. We have to continue to invest in those.
Okay, because I'd rather it went to spay and neuter than to the city of Tucson.
Yes.
Okay, I'm sorry, Karen.
No, and in fact, the plan that has been drafted for the estate gifts would take more than $500,000 and put it in this return project, which is our most effective spay and neuter program to date. You know, it's taken us to no kill for cats in like less than a year. So, just no, that's a big part of that, actually.
And I do have a question. Are you going to make your PowerPoint available for the members of the public that might want to know, can they click on it on the webpage? Because there are people who may want to look at this as well.
I can. If folks want it, I that would be great. So I'll keep this short. I know everybody's probably really hungry. Yes, please, Dr. McDonald, hold your former patient Max. So my name is Karen Hollish. I'm the Director of Development and Marketing for Pima Animal Care Center. And I'll keep this short and sweet because I know everyone's hungry. Or at least I am. So what does PAC's development program do? So obviously, and what's sort of on everyone's mind all the time, is that we raise much needed funds. PAC's annual budget is around $8.8 million a year. We have looked at other cities across the country that serve similar pet and people populations, and our budget should be closer to $13 million to be a fully funded shelter. So I was hired in March of 2014 to help close that gap because we've sort of gotten what we can from the taxpayers and somebody else needs to come up with the rest. But beyond the money, which we're going to get to in just a second, there are other things that I do. My job is called development and not fundraising because it's broader than just bringing in money. I'm here to develop programs that, I'm here to help develop programs and a culture that that is moving the organization forward and advancing it in a positive direction. So I strive and work really hard to create a culture of philanthropy here at PAC. Prior to me coming on board, we just didn't think much about donors or donations. Now I'm trying to encourage all my colleagues to consider everybody who walks through the door to adopt, to license, to redeem their pet, as a prospective $1 million donor, because you never know who you're dealing with, and we should treat everyone as if they have that capacity to give. I also work really hard to market our successes and build positive relationships with the media and build a positive public image of PAC. There's really been no one here to do that in a dedicated way. One of my favorite parts of my job is to work with my operations colleagues on helping build progressive and innovative programs that people will want to fund. So I get to weigh in on things like the help desk or the TNR program and suggest how those things will come off to prospective donors. And another big part of my job that I really love is I get to seize the moment and tell the story of our team's amazing work. Many of you might recognize Officer Chris Meek in the picture there with Sunny the dog, who came to us this year. That was a dog who was left hanging from a tree. I'm sad to say it, but PAC has probably taken in dogs like that for decades and decades and decades, but no one's been here to tell the story. So it's part of my job when those amazing miracles are happening, like to go out and be a cheerleader for PAC and be a cheerleader for the staff and the volunteers who are making saves like this happen. But now, on to the money, because that's what most folks care about. What do we raise and how do we do it? In the last 20 months that I've been on the job, we've raised more than $1.4 million in cash donations for PAC and its nonprofit partners. In the past, that was PAC Partners. That was a nonprofit that's sort of been phased out of existence. Now our primary nonprofit partner is the Friends of Pima Animal Care Center. When we include planned gifts that Dr. Garcia is going to talk about a little bit more, that figure rises to $2.9 million.
And we've raised well above $700,000 in in-kind support for the shelter during that time. So that counts things like the best friends, folks who are based here. It counts things like canned food that the volunteers bring, blankets, towels, pill pockets, isolation gowns, all those things from our Amazon wish list is reflected in that figure. And I suspect it's a lot higher. We will be getting donor software and a person to help track those gifts in the next fiscal year, so we'll get a better handle on actually how much we're raising and that stuff. So that's a conservative estimate. How do we raise money? The way every nonprofit or fundraising director raises money, we do direct mail appeals, so we send out letters asking people to give. I do grant writing, I do online campaigns, matching campaigns, planned and major gifts, and special events. So I have two goals for this year. And the first one, there's two big things I'm working on. And the first one is to raise $600,000 in cash donations directly to PAC, just so we have a balanced budget. It's actually written into the PAC budget that $600,000 of our operating revenue needs to come to donation through donations, or we will be under budget. So I like to think of that as what we're paying for our amazing new doctors and all the medical care we're doing. That is a huge change that's happened at PAC in the last couple years, and it has a big price tag. So donations made directly to PAC help underwrite that progress, and it's really amazing. My second goal, after meeting that $600,000 goal, is to build a robust, independent, nonprofit partner for PAC. So that's the Friends of Pima Animal Care Center. It's currently a project fund held with the Community Foundation for Southern Arizona, and we're working to get our independent 501c3 status. Like, currently the Community Foundation is like our fiduciary agent, but we'll be independent. Hey, Tammy's on the board, actually. Yay, Tammy. We'll be independent by October of 2016. And the Friends of PAC was formed so that there's a place for donors who don't wish to give to the government or who wish to have the feeling that they get when they give to a nonprofit. They can give to the Friends of PAC, and their donations can be used a lot more flexibly to help the pets. The top two funding priorities for the Friends are medical equipment, services and supplies, and behavioral equipment, services and supplies. So over the past year, the Friends has been in existence. They've invested in things including a dental x-ray machine, IV fluid pumps, long-acting pain medication for the cats, Convenia for cats, so many things like Parvo tests when we ran out of Parvo tests in the middle of the summer, Giardia tests when we ran out. What's that?
Gowns,
pill pockets, all of that stuff. The Friends of PAC is there to meet the critical needs when the county can't or won't. So the Friends of PAC is really great, and expect to hear more from them in the coming year. So how can you help with all of this? Please, please, please be a PAC cheerleader. I'm not going to pretend that it's always happy endings at PAC, but we have more happy endings happening now than ever. 5 years ago, in 2010, our save rate was about 50%. I just crunched the numbers last night for this calendar year to date. We're at like 88.5%. Now, it's still sad for those pets who are part of that percentage that's not making it out, but what we need to, the image we need to project to the public is that we are making progress, and that more happy endings happen here than sad, and you should come out to PAC to make your own happy ending happen. So I encourage you to be a positive cheerleader for PAC, because if we present this place, present PAC as a place that's happy and fun to visit, more people will come and more of our pets will get adopted. Please be patient with me on a personal level. The goals that have been set for me are really audacious, and I've got a lot on my plate, so if you contact me about wanting to do a fundraiser or something, I really appreciate your patience while I work to get back with you. And if I say no, it probably means no, not right now, but in the future, I may be able to take up that opportunity when we have more staff. So I appreciate your patience while I work to fill that $600,000 goal. I was going to say deficit, but goal is a lot more positive. And please be an advocate to the donors who support our work. Tonight you guys are going to consider some pretty important issues. think about if you had left Pima Animal Care Center's pets in your estate, how would you want that gift to be used? If you added $10 onto your license, how would you want that gift to be used? Please think about that tonight and draft your resolution with that in mind. So does anyone have any questions for me? Really? Okay, you guys must be hungry. I'm here if you need anything.
Thank you.
I personally want to thank you for the excellent job you're doing.
Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate that. Thank you.
So first of all, let me recognize that actually the incredible progress that we've made in the development area is due to two things, I believe. Number one, the fact that we've been able to have somebody like Karen here who has dedicated herself to really helping us figure out how to resource these things that we feel we need to do for pets. That's things like medical care, shelter, spay and neuter, that may or may not be statutory mandates to us. Remember, we only have to do what the law requires. We want to do a hell of a lot more, but we only have the resources for much less than that. And that's part of the reason why this is so incredibly important. Understand that when we project a certain amount of revenue, donation revenue, into the budget, in part it's because the state requires us to tell taxpayers, the state requires us to be very explicit about what kind of authority, budget authority, that we've been given. And so we can't, if somebody comes in with $1 zillion today and writes a check to PAC, we can't actually use that check. We can't actually use that check unless we run through some very important machinations to make it legal. There's just explicit Arizona revised statutes that preclude us from doing that. So I want to talk about just such a situation. One of the things that is very, very rare in government, there is nowhere else in government where folks are care as much about the issue, number one, B, are willing to put their dollars where their heart is. So nowhere else in government have I ever seen that. Now, I got to tell you that sometimes I wish it were, because as Dr. Smith will tell you, there are things that we would like to do on the health side that I would love to have somebody give us $1 million to do, but there's just not that buy-in. But on this issue, it's very, very clear that this community considers these priorities. And that's part of the reason why I believe that the bond proposition passed in almost every single precinct. Almost every single precinct. I believe there were two or three exceptions. So I think that that's pretty darn amazing. I think that that indicates a level of commitment, a level of awareness that quite honestly isn't there on any other issue. So we have the very fortunate circumstance of being the beneficiaries of the generous gifts of two women who had potentially very minor interactions with PAC, but who have left us significant resources from their estates, Ms. Ella Jane Burson and Ms. Marilyn Rasmussen. I only mention them in the same sentence because the money came in at about the same time. They did not know each other. They have completely different kinds of money. But in total, the value of those planned gifts is somewhere in the neighborhood of $1.3 million. I tell you $1.3 million because at this point, we haven't sold the house, which is the last asset of the Rasmussen estate. We've gone through some title issues, but it will be going up to the market, and we believe it will fetch somewhere in the neighborhood of about $100,000. So, a month, 2 months down the road, I'll be able to tell you what the total value of those combined estates. When we first got those specific, very generous estate donations, one of the things that I realized very quickly is that we needed to figure out how to honor the wishes of the individuals who were making those donations. And even though I had not met any of them, and even though we don't have a great record of what it is that they wanted the dollars spent on, to me it was clear that they wanted it to be spent on animals. to me, it was clear that they didn't want it to be spent on administrative things, for instance. To me, it was clear that they wanted this to be spent on things that were innovative and transformational, and it helped us do things that we could not otherwise do. So when you get a big wad of money like that, you have to develop an investment plan. And so what I did was craft for the deputy county administrator what we called our investment plan for the Burschen and Rasmussen bequest. And we did it very carefully because we knew that this was, we were establishing a precedent. What we are going to do in the future is what we've memorialized in this, the process that we're going to go through. And so what we identified as part of this investment plan are four priority areas. These are four things that we would not otherwise do without these resources. These are four things that we believe are going to have important residual benefit to animals. This investment plan, just like your personal investment plan, is not a short-term deal. This is a five-year investment plan. The idea is not to blow the whole 1.3 off the bat, because we could easily do that. But the idea is to make strategic investments that will allow us to draw money from folks like PetSmart and other charitable givers so that we can continue to build the capacity. So the first thing that we said that we would do, and that the first priority that we articulated, was the continued support of the community cat program. The community cat program that was made possible by Best Friends and PetSmart Charities has an expiration date. Their contribution to that program will actually expire in the fiscal year 17-18. And for us, it's really important that the progress that we've made, i.e. we've gotten to almost no-kill kinds of numbers on the cat side of things, we believe that that's important progress that our community wants us to continue. So $500,000 of this bequest is being set aside starting in 17-18 to support the operations of the community cat program. We call it the community cat program for at least the 2 years after the funding is exhausted. So that will help us continue something that we don't have the resources to do, quite honestly, unless we have these resources. Number two, the second thing that has been a really recurrent issue for us is that as we've gotten better at placing animals with special needs, placing animals in foster settings, one of the things that continues to be a major issue for us are dogs with behavioral issues. I believe, from my understanding of how this issue plays out in other communities, this is like one of the last frontiers of things that we really need. If we're going to decrease the kill rate for these breeds of animals that are more aggressive, we're going to have to figure out how to mitigate their behavior. And so part of what we've built into this, and this starts with this calendar year, this next calendar year, is building a behavioral, what we've called a behavioral rehabilitation program. And that means hiring staff who are behaviorists, who are folks who will help us make these animals be more adoptable and safer in the settings that they go. We've set aside $296,000. We begin that investment in January of 2016. We are starting to craft the positions, for instance, that would be involved. The third area...
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
How many years is that 296 gonna...
So we made a two-year commitment on that.
I'm sorry.
Two-year commitment. With the goal of hopefully attracting some sort of matching commitment at some point. Oh, sorry, three-year commitment. Yes.
Three-year, two people?
Three-year, yes. It's not one whole FTE, and that's part of the reason why. It's only $300,000, but it is over a three-year time frame. So the next piece is building what we originally called the Pet Resource Center, but what is probably more correctly termed an owner and adopter support unit. And we know that a lot of folks who adopt animals, we know a lot of folks who have animals at home, sometimes run into behavioral and non-behavioral issues with their pets that might make them want to get rid of them. And we believe that for those folks, for those owners who are honestly committed to keeping those pets in their home, that we need to help them come up with other solutions. And so this support unit, the support center, really is about helping people be successful pet owners and helping folks who have, once they've made the decision to give up their animal, that we do it in a way that we can plan for, that we can staff for, so that the intake is happening on a rational basis, so that we can do the kinds of things that we need to do to optimize the outcome for the animal. The investment for that area is about $189,000. That is leveraged against about $149,000 from PetSmart Charity. So we made an initial commitment of $189,000. PetSmart Charity has come in with $149,000. So you can see that's my thinking all along, is that we really need, this is just chump change in some respects. This is seed money that we need more to keep something like this going. So the money that we had set aside would originally take us, was fairly modest over a 3-year period. With these additional PetSmart resources, gives us a lot more capacity. By the way, there's a pet resource center that the Arizona Humane in Phoenix operates. They have 10 people. This is not going to be quite at that level. They offer lots of giveaways and tangible support, material support. We don't have the budget for that, but I believe that we have the beginnings of an infrastructure to be able to do that in the future. The last thing that I believe that we need to invest in is to continue to build our capacity for development. I believe that unless we continue to invest in that side of the house, that these donations will eventually dry up. And I think that's a full-time job. Karen does it very well, but Karen's just one person. And so this supports additional staffing, software, equipment. We're still trying to figure out exactly what it looks like, how it's housed, where it's housed organizationally. But beginning in the new fiscal year, that's when we would start working on that component. The last part of the document says that part of our job is to be good stewards of these resources and to be responsible stewards of these resources that are donated to us. So that the things that we are doing with this need to not supplant things that we are mandated by government to do. They need to supplement. And I realize that that's kind of a subtle difference, right? For instance, licensing, we're mandated. We have to do it. Control of dogs running at large. That there's a state statute that says a county will do X, Y, and Z, and it is the county's job to dedicate resources to do that. These things that we're investing in with these resources are not mandated things. These are things that we believe in the long run are in the best interest of the welfare of the pets in this community and in the best interest of the health of the entire county. I put it in those terms because, again, some of the jurisdictions have said, well, Francisco, why don't you just give us a discount on our, this should roll up to our bill and this should be reflected as a credit. Not in such simplistic terms as I'm putting it, but essentially the message being, these are our donors, our residents. Why is this not double taxation? You know, they're being taxed and then they're donating and then you're not going to use it to offset our bill. So I would suggest that it's really important that they hear from you in terms of how you think this money should be used. Whether you support the idea of using these bequests for very targeted, programmatic, I believe transformational kinds of programs, or whether you agree with them that perhaps it should go to underwrite or support their total obligation. I think that's the question before you. I'm happy to take any questions, but that was it. That I wanted to mention.
Go ahead, Mr. Jacobs.
Thank you.
and I may not have the figures exactly right, but as I understood it, you said approximately $800,000 is designated revenue for your budget.
Approximately $600,000, not of this.
No,
of the donations.
$600,000 of new donations for this fiscal year, approximately. They get a report that there may be $1.4 million or some such. What happens to the difference between that which you can use in your budget and that which comes in with, you know, the other $800,000?
That's a very good.
Does it all go to that charity, or is it placed in a holding fund for next year? What happens to that?
That's a very good question, Madam Chair, Mr. Jacobs. That's a very good question. So much of that comes from these arrangements that we have with PetSmart, right? PetSmart just turned around and wrote us a $149,000 check. So how we treat those things are as contracts with that entity. And we say, they've asked us to do these services, and this is the value of these services. That's how we're not getting around the budgetary authority issue, but we're treating that money as different so that we can use it actually for the things that the donor said that they wanted us to use it for. That's how we're treating these dollars too. We're not treating them as general donations, as the donations that come in through the licensing fee, for instance. So in that licensing fee kind of donation category, we only make about $200,000. Is that right, Karen? Is that my
record? Well, we have the software we need. We won't know for sure. But
okay.
Yeah, it's about, before I started soliciting donations in other areas, we raised about $200,000 a year in donations, and the assumption is most of that came from licensing.
And so those dollars go to support three things that are non-mandated. Medical care of animals, so that's what's allowed us to do some of the life-saving things that we've been able to do with our veterinary team. Spay and neuter, because even with the dollars that we get for the community cat program, there are many other, we provide low-income folks across this community spay and neuter vouchers in very large amounts. That's, we have a $600,000 budget item that is just spay and neuter.
And that's not included in the in their appropriations?
No. Well, it is, well, because there's revenue. There's revenue that comes off of it, right?
Well, I'm trying to understand.
Mm-hmm.
You have to state your revenues, and you have to state your expenditures. And now I'm trying, and you said $800,000 in donations. We get $1.4 million. But now you're saying there's also, because that those donations can be considered special efforts outside that budget, i.e. the...
Some of those donations.
Right. But is there any of those donations which are not spent in a fiscal year?
No. Well, for the most part, those dollars will be spent in the current fiscal year, except for those things that are, for instance, these contracts that we have.
I'm not talking about the trust fund.
Right. Okay. When Karen talks about the bulk of the donations, understand that it is PAC, it is PAC partners. It's not
Friends.
I'm sorry, Friends of PAC. I'm sorry, it's PAC and Friends of PAC. So yeah. that's a separate entity. And so yes, some of those dollars go directly into this year's budget line, in the neighborhood of $600,000.
Right.
Others are dollars that are either in the process of coming in or that will come in next fiscal year, but that have been, for all intents and purposes, secured. Does that make sense?
So what is that $600,000 increase in your next budget?
No. That so when I go to the board next year, I will propose a budget. And that budget will contain some revenue propose some revenue that comes from donations, not more than the $600,000. I believe that that's probably the max that we can expect on that end of things. but it's certainly, you know, more than $500,000. We have to sort of count on that in order to support the medical, the shelter, and the spay and neuter, the additional spay and neuter that we do above and beyond what is required by law.
And I guess my last question is, how would a group or individual be able to donate like the $140,000 that you said was you considered as a service, so that it would be, so that individual or group would know that it's not going to the line item budget, it's going to the what?
You could donate to Friends of PAC. That's the easiest, quickest, simplest way that those dollars would go to a group of people. Tammy Barrett is one of the members of that board of directors. There are four members of that board. And they have priorities that they will support. So that is probably the easiest. You get a nice little tax write-off statement. That is the easiest, cleanest way of doing it. You could have your own foundation. I could have the Francisco Garcia Foundation. And the Francisco Garcia Foundation could say, I'm going to enter into a contract with PAC, and PAC is going to do, to support special needs adoptions of cats.
All those monies would still be reported to us in this,
yes,
this month's budget.
Yes, we will still report them to you, and we will still report them to the Board of Supervisors.
Thank you for your time.
Absolutely.
Thank you. I just want to say that Karen has done a great job of fundraising, and I think this proposal is an excellent way to, number one, to use that money, probably the way the two women who left it to PAC would like it to be used, and in a good way that their families will be happy about the way the money is being used, and it will also help people in the future feel good about leaving money to PAC, because this is ongoing. This is not just a donation. This is the future for PAC. So I would make a motion that the advisory committee strongly send a letter to the Board of Supervisors that we support this.
I'll second that.
All those in favor?
Aye. I'm sorry.
Discussions.
What, can you explain in a sentence what this is?
This proposal for the money that was left by that Dr. Garcia just represented us. He just discussed with us.
Is it in here?
The four parts.
No, he just gave us the
one you just, the outline we heard?
Yes. Right.
Is there a written statement somewhere?
I thought it was in the materials. Here's the document. The document's a matter of public record.
I downloaded the document, and
therefore we didn't think that we needed to.
Can we add one more question? Why not? Dr. Garcia, Karen said that she needed to raise $600,000 to offset the budget. Is that correct?
So Karen's goal was to help us identify about $600,000 in donations to help support senior medical and shelter expenses.
Okay. Well, that was my question is, with the pet fix or the spay-neuter money, that's been right at close to $300,000. Is that included in that?
No. So if you'll recall, Chair Hentage, Ms. Hubbard, if you'll recall, 2 years ago, Mr. Huckleberry actually wrote a memo that said that we will continue to invest in spay and neuter, that this is a high priority. However, what that memo didn't say is where would those resources come from. About 400 grand come from general fund kinds of resources, but some of them actually do come from the donation side of the house. So,
thank you.
As you indicated, that out of the 100 proposals that were out around the bond, there was 100 one was passed by this committee, and that's the one for the animals. So you're right, it gives an indication as to what this community feels as far as how their money, and they're willing to spend even more. Now, is there a thought possibly within Pima County itself, leadership, that we presently have a so many billion dollar budget to take care of this many things? Now, clearly the community has said this area is very important to them. And considering we know that it has been somewhat overlooked over the last 30 years, that some of the resources that we use right now to fund all those other areas that, by the way, never got a nod of saying these are good because they didn't pass anything to help them. Is it possible that we could look at seeing how important this is in our next budgetary process? I mean, I know that you go and you request those funds. Is it something that they're looking at, or that you could at least show them that, just what I'm saying, that this particular issue takes precedence, or this facility takes precedence over many of the things that are going on in Pima County as we presently have funded? So when could we maybe hope that this facility then gets budgeted properly, picking up that 600 and more, because we know it's about 8.8 versus 13 million. And in an overall budget of billions, you know, for the county, that's not that much for this place. So your commentary on that.
So, Madam Chair, Mr. Newman, the point that you make is a really important one. And the administrator is acutely aware of how high this is on the priority list. He's also aware of a lot of other priorities that are being articulated to him on a daily basis. Things that may not have won for a variety of reasons, or they may have won in regional areas. I will continue to advocate for appropriately resourcing PAC. My sense is that given what our revenue projections are for the county, that we will not accept a slip down. But I wish I could tell you that I anticipate growing the budget by 5%. I cannot. I want a slow, steady incline. I will propose a slow and steady incline, understanding that our revenue basis has not yet recovered from the economic downturn. I do think that at some point, as the economy starts to turn, this is a really good conversation for stakeholders to have. And that may be the advantage of having a more politically sensitized board, in that they are able to sort of make that case. Because I think at the end of the day, these are political decisions. People ask me, Francisco, why are you building a $22 million shelter instead of a clinic on the south side, instead of building X, you know, repairing potholes? People will continue to do that. My response to them is the community has clearly spoken that this is a priority above and beyond a lot of other things, and therefore we are honoring the wishes of the electorate, at least on the day that they cast their votes, by using those resources for this. So I think your comments are good. I do think they bear sharing with our sort of political, or they bear sharing with your political representatives, how you feel about them, how other people feel about them, and because ultimately those are sort of political resource determinations.
Thank you.
Okay.
Call for the vote.
As memory serves, we have a motion on the floor to write a letter of support to the Board of Supervisors. I'm calling for the vote. All those in favor of a letter to the Board of Supervisors supporting the current plan.
Supporting the what?
Current
version of investments and requests.
Okay. Investment plan. All those in favor? All those against? Those who abstain?
Okay, so how many? There were none against. One abstain, and there was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 4.
The one left.
Two people left.
Two people left.
Okay. One more thing, okay. I'm going to do a call to the audience. Thank you everybody for being so patient, but I am going to do a call to the audience. Does anybody have anything to say? Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you.
Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second.
We are, okay. Oh, wait. Sorry, the next meeting is the 21st of January. And we will continue. And thank you everybody for being so patient.